And today, as a second afternoon first session, we are having leveraging data analytics in forensic engagements. It's a totally technologically driven topic, and we have with us one of the very well known and expert in digital technologies, probably the one who every one of you might be knowing very well, Anand sir. Anand sir was here on several occasions, and I think on forensic and data analytics, he may be the first time he is now taking classes. He was earlier with the blockchain and everything, as an excellent personality with the one excellent knowledge also. And he is here today to take this session for all of us. Here, I think you'll be getting more inputs on forensic audit as well as data analytics also. So both together, we'll be giving you good inputs. So this is the need of the hour, I think. Every professional should move towards digital technology. And the COVID-19 has really shown to us the way. And it is up to us to grab the opportunity and move ahead. So I hope today it will be a wonderful session for you. On behalf of Ernakulam branch, I extend a cordial welcome to Anand P. Jank sir for this session. Again, I would take this time to welcome my colleague in Managing Committee, Jos, as well as others to the session. It's my pleasure to welcome each and every one of you, because this is a Sunday holiday. It's a leisure time today after this your busy deadlines and all. So really a compliment to all of you who are present here today to attend this session, because you are all the people who are really interested in the session. And I think Ansar will be really motivated to see you all here because of this Sunday afternoon, your presence here. Anyway, once again, welcoming each and every one of you. Have a wonderful learning time. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Over to Jos for the proceedings, please.
Thank you, Chairman C. Rajbargis. I'm very happy and privileged to introduce our speaker, Anand Prakash Jangir. He's a passionate evangelist for tech-based disruption in audit and finance domain. Anand is professionally a chartered accountant and a certified information system auditor. He is managing partner at AJA, an organization with focus in the area of forensic audit, IS audit, fraud analytics, and blockchain for internal audit function. Anand was part of the risk management team at Goldman Sachs, covering multiple audits across much geography for different function in the organization. Well, his areas of specialization were forex audit, DP audits, anti-money laundering, Basel II, BCP, and operational risk. Prior to Goldman Sachs, he was with the ES Consulting Group at Infosys Technology Limited, Bangalore. He has been involved in enterprise risk management implementation and IT audit for many international projects at USA, UK, Japan, China, etc. He is a visiting faculty for IIM Bangalore, teaching IS audit and fraud analytics, and speaker at North America CACS and EuroCACS of ISACA. And he is a visiting faculty at ISACA, ICAI, and Wellinger Institute of Management. With these words, I invite.
Thank you, Josh, sir. I think you got in mute, sir. Somehow, Josh, sir, you got in mute, I think. Yes.
Yeah, now, yeah.
No, okay. Thank you. Thank you, Josh, sir, and thank you, Roy, sir. It's a pleasure, actually. And as Roy, sir, rightly said, I have been at Kochi so many times and so many sessions. When Roy, sir, told me, I said, sir, you know, people will be bored. I have to, you know, prepare for that something new which I can actually share. I don't want to share something I have been actually talking about a lot. So the topic for today, friends, is something which is very close to my heart, because this is personally I do for my bread and butter. Okay, this is like what brings food to the table for our firm. And I have been talking about many times about forensic engagements and how we are doing it. But I'm sure all of you, you know, first of all, amazing that you guys are here on on a Sunday afternoon, and that also post lunch session. Hats off to you. That means you are really interested on this session. And I just thought I will make this session. It's actually a 1 hour, 20 minute session, but I would like to keep it really, I would say very focused on the practical aspects. Today's session, as Royce rightly said, you had a session from Mr. Jain on Excel, which how we can use. And I'm 110% sure, because I've heard him also. What he says is something which can help us leverage to do our regular reviews, audit much better. But the focus for my presentation would be more on forensic engagement. If you are doing forensic engagement or you're trying to go into forensic engagement, what are the tools and techniques which we can use? And let's go down to the practicality as much as possible, not at 30,000 feet. I would request you to feel free to interrupt me at any point of time, ask any questions. And I would like to, take you through some of the things which we are doing in-house. And I think we have now, after 4 and 5 years, we have done a lot of trial and errors, and we have, streamlined the whole thing. So what I'm going to share with you is something which has come with a lot of learning internally, and I would request you to please use it. So that's something which I would like to cover for today's discussion, friends, that how we can actually leverage data analytics in forensic engagement. And I'm sure you have seen some of the cases which are coming nowadays. There are cases happening, there is an ED case which is going on right now, very famous in Kerala. And there are a lot of requirements to check the fund trails and all the things. It's very good to say, oh, we have to check the fund trail. But when you get into the role of doing it, I am sure it becomes a little tough. I was told that, we will be actually taking it as a base. We'll not try to do that. You are already aware of forensic and other things. So a little bit of fundamentals I will be covering in the beginning. And then we will deep dive into what are the different types of data analytics we can do, how we do it, what are the tools we use it, how to use the tools, even step-by-step approach. And this presentation I'll be sharing with the branch, so you can actually have that as your review point. And also some of the new thing which is happening. I'm not sure how many of you are practicing into AML area, anti-money laundering. It's amazing area, friends. I would highly recommend you to basically explore that area if you are a practicing chartered accountant, especially. This is one area which is now catching up because of a couple of things which has happened. And I am privy to some information which I cannot share right now, but you may see some of the stuff coming up very soon in the public domain also. Okay. So from that perspective, let's deep dive into the topic. Okay. This is a disclaimer which comes only for a second, and it goes. As I told you, I was told that I need to start from beginning. So a little bit of first, why do we understand all this data analytics, machine learning, all this concept which are there? Why we need to have a lot of, understanding of that? See, this is the number which I would highly recommend you to watch it. This number, what you're seeing on the screen, is basically what we call it as the amount of money. And I'm just telling you the latest report. You can actually download the latest report, 2020 report, which basically says that every organization in the world is losing 5% of their top line. A top line can be their budget, revenue, receipts, anything you can think of. It is a not-for-profit organization also, they may have receipts. All of that is getting lost on an average of 5% worldwide. And I just always show this number. If I just multiply Fortune 5000 companies turnover with 5%, that gives me 3.7 trillion USD. Now, what does it mean? I very well know our institute doesn't allow us to go for outcome-based pricing. But think of a situation where we go to our client and say, hey, you know what? I would come to your organization and we know it may not be 5%, maybe 3%, it may be 10%. In your organization, we'll find fraud. Okay? And if you find fraud out there, you have to give us 5% of the turnover or 5% of your fraud amount as fees. Just try to ask this question. Let's see how many of your clients are ready to that. None of them would be there because they know there are some fraud which are happening. Small organization, big organization, for-profit organization, government organization, fraud happens everywhere. Now, what does it make us? It makes us think that can we do anything about that, or we should just sit with your hands on the other hand and just be watching it that it's going to happen. So there are things which was not feasible. Last 10 years back, if 10 years back we have to have the discussion, I would have said, no, sir, it's not feasible. But a lot of things which has happened, and I always evangelized on how we can use technology more effectively. A lot of things which has changed in last 7 to 8 years allows us to do a lot of things. And I would like you to see that what are the things we can do to be able to take that forward in the right way. If you know, as per them, if you see this initial detection of fraud, you know, this is a little old figure, but I'm just telling you, even the latest figure I saw it, audits and internoids are still not able to provide a very good detection mechanism for fraud. And because they are not able to provide a very good detection mechanism for fraud, it is leaving a big gap in the market. Now, I'm not saying that we are not doing our external audit and internal audit properly. Fundamentally, there are some issues. Fundamental issues are either we have very less time, or the way we have been scheduling or working on that, we are not using the tools very effective, right? Today, if I have to go in a war on India-China border or India-Pakistan border, do you think I will go there with a 303 rifle, which used to happen, or the gun 303 used to come, right? Which we have seen in more, many of the police stations and all things. Do you think I will go to the war like that? Now, you will take the most modern weapons which you can find, and then you will go on the war. Now the same thing applies to us. When we go on our engagements, you know, these are the tools of the trade. I would like to basically work on more and more of all these tools which can help me do my job better, easier, faster, right? And there data comes into picture. And when I say data, I want to tell you that why did I say to you that 10 years back, if I would have tried to talk or take these sessions, that is 2010 or 2011, I used to work at Infosys at that time, this would have been much tougher. Reason is simple. We have an explosion of data. I hope all of you know, we have been talked about terabytes of data. But how many of you know, can you just see this? One bit is a 0 and 1. I started from 1 bit, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We are still actually talking at terabytes of data. How many of you are aware of that we have more of that? 10 terabytes become 1 petabytes. 1024 petabytes become 1 exabytes. 1024 exabytes become 1 zettabytes. 1024 zettabytes become a yottabytes. 1024 yottabytes become from brontobytes. And 1024 brontobytes become a geobyte. And I hope one thing which I have not added is 1024 geobyte also has been, you know, added out to that. Now, we are very happy till we discuss. Whenever we discuss, we discuss up to this point, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But I'm going 6 level above that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this has been a kind of a common thing we've been talking about. But why can't we basically go to the next 6 levels? And this is happening. Data explosions. I am sure a lot of people are nowadays sending messages on WhatsApp to you that we should quit WhatsApp. So imagine they're using WhatsApp only to tell you that we should quit WhatsApp. But yeah, Signal is good, Telegram is good. They're all talking about that. Imagine how much data we generate every day. What is happening today is we are having, personally speaking, okay, let me just remove the annotation, okay? Explosion of data. When I say explosion of data, they say that the 90% of the world data today was created in the last 2 years. And that's a very, very interesting figure, right? I don't know how many of you are started checking one thing in your audit procedures, that if there are inwards and outwards on a random basis, are you checking in the inwards and outwards if this vehicle numbers which has been mentioned there are correct or not by going to vahan.org? Why I'm telling you is vahan.org kind of, or you know, Vahan database of Government of India was not accessible for a long, long time. So what has happened is we have today access to a huge amount of data. I personally, you have seen this data.gov, this is actually of Government of US, but I would like to share with you and show you one more file, which is here. Let me show you. Okay, here we go. This is called data.gov.in. Just a minute. Okay, let me share the screen only. Okay, so I'll just move a kind of thing out there just to show you what I'm trying to show. So there is something called data.gov.in. I am not sure how many of you have gone in. Now, this is a site which I kind of go on a, I would say every weekly basis, Sunday. I'm actually today in office only. And Sunday is the day when I explore what are the new set of data. Government of India, and not just Government of India, there are people who have signed to one of the, you know, UN Declaration for Data Governance, who have, like, even US has put data.gov, India has put data.gov.in, even Kenya has put their data, every country is putting their data out. Can you imagine that there are 175 departments of central and state government which has put data? There are so much of APIs are there, there are visualization. There are so much of data about Vahan, about different departments, IRDA and all things, which is actually helping us to do things, which is that. And this was not possible. I'm just giving an example, 10 years back. And this 10 years has been a transformation which has happened. We have access to so much of data, we can't just imagine it. Okay? And this data, is there a way to use it? Now you have something in, you know, a lot of abundance. Should we use it or not use it? If we don't use it, we are fools, because it's in front of us and we are not using it. So how can we use it? Okay, that's the question we should be asking. I have nowadays, I don't know, on LinkedIn, you should go and search one word, audit analytics. You'll find thousands of people all over the world doing what we call it as audit analytics. Now, what has happened is there is an increasing business value which is coming out there. Why? You can just set it up once and it will keep on doing it again and again. Repetitive task. You don't have to depend on humans so much. You know, we always have this problem. This guy joined us, he left it up and all things. Let him leave. We don't require him because it can be automated out there. So it's a data analytics or audit analytics is a discipline of evaluation of a large set of data which discovers patterns. It can be an anomaly. It can be a trend. It can be preferences or anything which we think can be useful. And you have seen, this has been actually proven, that organization which implements a proactive data monitoring, what's happening with our data, what is the kind of things, they can detect frauds 58% faster compared to the peers. And they will also experience 52% less fraud than other organizations. And this is as per the report of the ratio. And this analytics allows us to analyze it, the whole data. See, one of the main thing in forensic engagement, all of you know, in audit, we go with materiality and sampling. We see the material transaction. But the point is, in forensic engagement, you need to check the complete population. You can't have, I will check the material transaction or not the immaterial one. I have to check the complete set of data. And when I do this complete set of data, it becomes important for me to understand what are the things which are happening. I hope you got my point. So there, this is adding a lot of value. Analytics is adding a lot of value. And these are some of the tools and technologies. And you know what is the most interesting thing? All these tools and technologies are more or less open source. You can see my favorite of this, let me announce some of them, are Pentaho. This is for business intelligence. Nine, I use it extensively. We are using Hadoop extensively, Cassandra database. Then we are using a lot of, these are all we are using, I'm just telling you, these are all open source technologies. You can choose whatever work for you. I'm just giving an example out here. And those things can add a lot of value in terms of what? In terms of processing a very large volume of data. When I say a very large volume of data, I'm talking about terabytes and terabytes of data. Because today, the computing power has become cheap. Data collection has become very high. And that leads to a lot of interesting analysis. We deal with a lot of external data. Earlier, we used to always say, I have to take the data from the client. But you have now access to a lot of external data. All my friends who are doing forensic engagement knows that no one supports you with data in a forensic engagement. It is something like what we call it as an engagement of a very favorite term some of my friend told me is, it's a single entry system of bookkeeping. We used to have this question come in examination, right? Convert a single entry books of bookkeeping into double entry. It is an assignment like that. And it is something very painful, okay? But this external data can help you to close the gap. Unstructured data. Nowadays, there are so much of data in Excel files, PDFs, and all things, which is not structured in a database or anything. Now, earlier, it used to be a big problem. But today, there are so much of easy way of extracting the data and putting it in the proper directory. Statistical modeling, we all know about things like Banford law and all things, and Banish models, which are all statistical models. This becomes easier if you have a tool. You can do it humanly. Everything can be done. Today, I can actually walk down 23 kilometers and go to the place. It's feasible. But would I do that? No. I have a car, I have a bike, or any other mode of transport I can use. Why should I walk? So I should be using it and taking it forward. We have machine learning. I'll be discussing that later. And the two very important things which I think we are not using is, you have heard about this term concurrency or concurrent audit, but it is also called as continuous monitoring. So from a continuous monitoring perspective, today we can do a real-time analysis. How the transactions are happening, what are the key things which are working out there, and what are how we need to take them. So those stuff can be done, and a picture is worth a thousand words. So when you visualize it, let's say I'm just talking about something like linear regression. in linear regression, it will give me which are the anomalies which are there. Now, when I see this one transaction, which is, you know, very far off from the median, then I know, okay, something is fishy out there. So this interactive visualization is something which is very powerful too. And as a forensic engagement expert, I have to use it. In fact, you can use it without that also, no problem at all. But I'm just giving you the perspective that in perspective of using it, we can add a lot of value. Okay, friends? So this is what we have as a kind of, you know, working thing. But now a lot of people ask me, so this is the reason I actually made a lot of step-by-step approach. So, you know, I was making this presentation, I was thinking, okay, what is that thing which is there? So let's say you are a person who have never done any data analytics work. How do you start with? So the step one is what we call as information collection. You have to collect your input sets, or you have to analyze the source and what types of data which you are using, and how have you procured that in what, from which source? Is it internal source, external source? Everything we need to look into that. So friends, that is what we call as information collection, becomes the first step out there. Second step is data integrity check. Now, this is very important. There are, you know, we have a 6-step integrity checklist I'll be sharing with you. We always say, you know, this is one very interesting thing happened. Around 3 years back, I was attending one conference of IIA in New York. It was an annual, you know, global conference, annual conference which was there in New York. And there was an head of audit of AIG, which is a very big insurance company, who has come. And the topic of discussion was how to use data analytics in audit. And I asked one question as an audience question. I asked him, sir, what do you think is the biggest challenge? He said, it is not doing the analysis, which is the biggest challenge. It is getting the data ready for analysis is the biggest challenge. So the data integrity check need to be one of the key thing which we have to look into. Step three would be formatting the data. When I say formatting the data, it has to be brought out. We use a term called ETL, it will be coming in. Extract, transform, load. It is basically a more of a technical term, friends. But what we need to understand is there is data into different structures. There is something which we call in database like primary key and secondary key. How can I connect the dots between multiple data sets? Because I'm not going to do it only with one data set, right? So I need to have a kind of formatting which has to be taken care of. Friends, once I have done the formatting, then I go to what we call as the model development. Model is what? Let me explain you the thing. Model is your intellectual thought which you are putting into the system. You are saying that I want data from X, I want data from Y, and see the differences which are there from that. That's a model. It's a reconciliation model. Or I would like to do a three-way match. There is data coming from 5 different sources. I would take all this data together, match it, and then try to do it. That is also a model. Depending on what the forensic accounting would like to do, you can develop any model which comes to your mind. So model development has to be done. Yes, when we do on machine learning, I'll be discussing machine learning with all of you also. And maybe if possible, I'll show you some demo also. In machine learning, we will have to develop a very comprehensive model, and that has to come out of that. And once the model is developed, then you connect the data sources with the model, and it will process and analyze that data. Because already you have all the data through your model, it will give you a complete picture of, okay, this is what is happening, this is how it is basically going out, and take that forward. In the next step, I will show you what is that ETL part, which is all data integrity and all the thing that I will discuss with you later. But here, please remember one thing. In step 5, we are doing the processing and analysis of it. You got my point? And once it is all there, we start doing the reporting. So this is how a kind of a steps which goes in starting from information collection. Then we have data integrity check, we have data formatting, we have model development, we have processing and analysis, and ultimately what we call as the reporting. Now here, if you see, the most challenging part is this part. Step number 1, 2, and 3. These are the challenging one. Why do I say this are the challenging one? Others, you can manage it easily. You will not have any kind of problem, but you will have more problem in this one. Now to overcome that, what is the different approach we can take? We have a concept called ETL. And I would like you to understand the steps which are there in ETL in a right perspective, friends. Why I say right perspective? It's an example I'm just trying to give you, okay? Let's say I'm trying to do some analysis of NPA data from bank, okay? And I would like to understand how I can actually take that forward. I'm taking examples of some of the tools which is very easily available to any chartered accountant, which are there, Microsoft tools. So I hope you know you are using Office 365. How many of you know that Office 365 also have the, you know, license for Power BI? Power BI is one tool I would highly recommend you start using it. It's very easy to use. Even the, you know, our team members can very easily become expert on that. And we need to have a complete controls over that part. So maybe you get data from bank statements and system. Then once you have done it, you transform the data which you have got it from, let's say, you know, in Power BI, and from there you get it back out. You have to read the system data into the, you know, and load it into the model which we are having. We have to build, validate, and predictive graph. And ultimately, we have a proper visualization which is ready. So what you are seeing is, this is nothing but a subset of what we discuss. And when we are doing it, here we talked about using Power BI. There are many independent theorems, laws, or models which are there. You can actually look into whatever you would like to use, depending on what kind of problem you are doing. If you are trying to see whether the population of data is natural or, you know, something which has been manipulated, you can use MenFedLog, because it's something. I'm not going into all of these things. You can actually, you know, Google it out, or if you want something more, I will share it later, because we have to finish. I want to have 20 minutes for question and answer. I want to really interact with you guys on this. Second one is called Vanish model. Vanish model is nothing but, if I put 2 years financial statement, that is balance sheet of a company, into Vanish model, it will tell me which area there are problems. Okay, so you can actually look into that. We have Bayes Bayes theorem, which is about finding anomalies. We have relative size factor. We all know this concept of relative size factor. I take the highest amount, the lowest amount, and, you know, divide by that. If it is more than 10, then it looks like something not okay. There is three-way matching, taking data from multiple sources and matching it up, just like we do in procurement, you know, when we are doing purchase and other things, we will be trying to do that. So during this analysis, what we are doing, we have to ensure that we try to see, is there any places where a significant excessive cash is there? There is unusual disbursement of cash. All these indicators will give you a kind of understanding of any falsified, you know, dealing which can happen. So this is something which we need to look into. Moving forward, the overall approach, if you have to do it in forensic, I'm just using the string approach for forensic engagement. The first and foremost, or the easiest one to do, is anomaly detection. Okay, we call it as anomaly detection. Is nothing but, you can see this thing, we use this term called control charts. So in control charts, when we start putting it at that, I can actually easily figure it out if there is something which has happened which is not working and all thing. And that gives me a kind of a complete picture of any deviation from the patterns, old patterns to this, should be actually given to me. Also, if there are some kind of anomaly which is there. Anomalies are what? Let me explain to you. When we use the word anomaly, we are trying to say anything which doesn't look like a normal, you know, transaction, normal process. That is an anomaly. And an anomaly can happen because of multiple things. It could be by mistake, it could be intentional, but anything which is there, we have to do that. So we need to look into that, you know, what are the things which are happening and see the signals which are coming. And the tools, I just wanted to give a very specific list of tools to you. And these are something which you can easily, you know, get into that. And all of them are more or less free, except for maybe Power BI. All of them are free. You don't have to charge, you know, you don't have to pay even a single rupee. Power BI also is actually part of your Office 365. Unless it is not there, it will cost you something around 60 rupees per month. I think that is all which you'll be taking out. It's not a big deal. All these things, if you start using it, friends, I'm telling you, we can do wonders. I will actually take you some real examples now. It will be a little bit of not a very, it will be a little busy slide. A lot of text would be there. But the reason I wanted to keep it busy only because I wanted to discuss with you. That one is like something which we, you know, do day in, day out. And don't get scared by, oh, we have to use Python, we have to use Spark. These are very normal things nowadays. And nowadays, the focus is on a term called low code or no code. Low code or no code is you don't require to know coding to be able to use all these things. You can actually just plug and play and basically work on that. Okay. So how do we do this? Like NIME is something which I always promote and all things. It's an open source. You can please download it up. And you don't have to do any coding. You have to just drag and drop. It will do all the work. SQL, MSL, MySQL is free. You can just download it as a database. Python, maybe you have to learn a little bit of that. R, you may have to do it. Power BI in Excel is just like Excel, only Power BI. So I think no CA will go for a training on all things. Once you get your hands a little dirty on that, I'm sure you'll be able to deal with that. So I just took two examples of fund analysis, you know, suspicious funds. I want to make sure that, you know, let's say, for example, usually we get this kind of assignment from bank that end use of fund, please check for that. Or check the fund analysis, how they have been using it, misusing it and all the things. And usually what happens is we don't have a lot of time to do it. Manually, we try to do it as much as we can, but then it doesn't work. So some of the approach which you can actually use, I just thought I'd share with you, is try to see, start from compartmentalizing the whole different kind of thing. Let it say expenses. You all the expenses, you should compartmentalize it and make sure you list out what looks like a suspicious or unaccounted for expenses, which you think is there, but it is not coming in any of them. Compare the proposed uses of fund against actual use. For there also, we can actually feed it in the tool and it can actually classify it up. Okay, this is how, you know, the uses of fund is supposed to be for CapEx, but here we are seeing it is being used for, let's say, paying salary and all that kind of stuff. So we need to look into that. Also, we can actually check in this, you know, what we call it as your review of any suspected transactions on check register or integrity of that. Are the, you know, sanction fund which has been given, are they being used for any private purpose? See, any forensic engagement you take, friends, if it is dealing with that, the first thing that, you know, if it is a bank fraud, they will always say that, please get us the fund, you know, money trail, where the money came from, where the money went. Now, doing it, you know, manually is a pain. It's a very long, long process. I mean, this can be done. It's not like it can't be done, but it is a very long process. So we need to see all these things, and this can be automated online. We have done it. That's why I'm just sharing with you. You can actually just put it up that, okay, we are classifying all this data into different thing. The, you know, Excel-based statement has been fed into the system, and you get all this information out there. And you can try to see who is doing out there. And also we can put it up into, let's say, Power BI to see a different cluster. We use the word clustering. We cluster different types of, you know, data separately, data separately, expenses separately, and all the thing. And that gives us a complete picture of how it is working. I hope you got my point, friends. Feel free to ask me any questions in place of that. I'm just sharing with you, okay? more of end use and fund trail, we are just telling you. You can actually understand the intended use of the sanction of fund, because different funds are sanctioned for different things. We have to also do what we call it as not just one analysis. Now that you have on your hand a very powerful tools and you have the data, why don't we see the data from multiple dimensions? Use the word multiple dimension. So I see the data from, you know, 360 degree, from this perspective, from this perspective. And the depth view give me a good understanding on that. I can also see the shareholder patterns. Has the shareholder patterns changed over a period of time? Behavioral analysis. What is behavioral analysis? They're actually doing this kind of expenses again and again. Why? That can be a question which can do. How much is the money which is being put to related parties and group companies? That can be classified very quickly. What are the transactions? I know you will say, oh, there is a ledger which is there. I agree. But what happens is, how do you be sure about this ledger is correct or not? When we are doing a forensic engagement, we have to see everything. And you know, when it goes to, you know, insolvency courts, you know, 2 years data, all transaction has to be reviewed. And the effort and time it takes is very, very high. So I am just thinking, can we reduce the time? Can we reduce the effort to a greater extent so that we can actually do it better? And then, you know, all of these things, anomalies which are there, can be picked up and kept separately, which can be further investigated. So basically, we call it as a funnel approach. When I say funnel approach, friends, what I'm trying to do is I am getting the data and putting it through a funnel, and it is telling me out of all this data, this 200 or 300 transaction looks suspicious. Please go deep into that instead of wasting your time on everything. It doesn't make sense. My mentor used to tell me, it doesn't make sense to boil the ocean. You don't want to boil the ocean. You take some water out of the ocean, boil it up and get what you want. It doesn't make sense to boil the ocean. And the last but not least, visualization of the fund trail will tell you, if you visualize the fund trail, it will give you a very good picture. Today, any of the report we make, it's actually a storytelling. And storytelling with data, you can see with photo, with map, heat map, these are all the different kind of tools you can use it up. I'm just giving example. We use photo, map, data map, how the data came from one place, small multipliers, line diagram, vertical bar chart, all of these things. And this will give you a kind of a complete picture of what is the narratives we are trying to make it out. I hope you got my point. What I'm going to show you is, I can actually just go into NIME also, it's open on my laptop, but I have just made the, you know, one program, and I'm just showing you, this is the program in NIME, how it looks like. You can just see that I have just started with file reader. You know, you read the pre-processing, some of the tools which is there, training set, basically how I would like that data to be analyzed. I am put my columns and all thing, and it is just like boxes, boxes, boxes. I connect data and I get my all the error status in one. It's something as simple as that. You know, how many boxes I put? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11 boxes, my program is ready. But yeah, I should know which box to put where. That is the most important thing. But it's a very simple job which you can actually do it, right? And when we use that along with a proper visualization, which tells what is the trend which is happening, what are the way it is moving, how they are doing it up, we can get a very good understanding of all the things. Okay, let me give you an example. What are the things which people are using it in forensic engagement, especially on trade-based money laundering? Trade-based money laundering is where, you know, you have this issues like over invoicing. Okay, you will see a lot of time when someone is trying to over invoice, they will they want to bring back the hawala money back in India, so there is an over invoice. So the exporter will submit an inflated invoice, and greater value is transferred from the importer to the exporter, right? Then second come under invoicing, where exporter submits a deflated invoice. We know what happened in the Reddy brother case in Bellary. You know the Bellary case which was there, the Reddy brothers did the same thing. What they were doing is, they actually were doing under invoicing. 10,000 rupees per ton iron oil was being exported at 1,000 rupees. And that is what we do with them. there are multiple invoicing, you know, where exporter do multiple invoice for the same shipment. This also basically is, you know, part and parcel of that. Over and under shipment, the shipment is not proper, they will do less shipment, or misrepresentation of quality. What they are trying to tell you is, it happens a lot in gold. They will actually say, we are importing, you know, let's say 18 karat gold, but actually it's a 24 karat gold. So other misrepresentation of that. Now, all this kind of stuff also, over a period of time, if we get data, we can actually easily manage and analyze that. Now, friends, this is what a basic data analytics can do it, whichever tools I told you about that. But taking the game to the next level, to the second level, is where we need to understand a concept called machine learning. I hope you heard this concept called machine learning, guys. Yes, no, maybe. Okay. Let me just you know, explain you machine learning with a very basic example. Okay. So this example is, I'll not go to the, sorry, this one, keep it this side. Yeah. So what happened was, Google, you remember some time back, I'm sure, talking to people from coaching, and already there is too many top chess players in coaching. You know, Garry Kasparov, who was the world leader, lost to what we call it as one of the computer, IBM computer, you know, maybe 8-9 years back. You're aware of that case? That was, that machine was called Deep Blue. Okay. Now, Deep Blue was made with an investment of what we call it as something around, if I'm not wrong, 2 million. And what they did in case of that one was very interesting. These people, they said, we'll program the computer to think like a chess player. So it will think faster, it will do more calculation and do it. Now, what happened is, machine learning is a concept in which what we do is, we make the system do stuff repeatedly. So many times it is repeated that I can actually capture the essence of that. And the program is written by machine itself. I have to just give the data. Okay. If I have to just talk about the definition, let me not go too much. It says a computer program is said to learn from experience. E is like how many times he does it, with respect to some task called T. So they are doing the task T multiple times, and there is a performance measure called P. And if its performance on T as measured by P improves with experience on E, that is what we call it as machine learning. I don't want to go into all this PTE. I'll make it very simple for you. When I ask a kid not to play with fire, do you think the kid will listen to me? No. But if the moment the kid burns his finger, don't you think the kid will listen to me, or even listen to himself only? Now, same thing they are trying to do. They are saying, earlier it used to happen like, I will give the computer logic, connect to the data, and then computer will process. What if I, instead of giving logic, I give the data to the computer and ask him to make the logic? Computers today can do that. And machine learning is a kind of a part of what we call it as neural network, self-learning networks. And it's not very expensive also. You will see this. So as I was telling you, the chess program of our friends, which was written by IBM, was 2 million plus. And Garry Kasparov lost to the Deep Blue. But Google did the same experiment with another game called Go. Go is a game, which is a strategy game, which is played in, especially in China and South Korea, and North Korea also, I think. And it's a strategy game. Now, what happened is, they made a program. Their budget was only $5,000. The program will, they made two versions of the program, version A, version B. They made the same program the rules were given, just like in chess we have the rule, you know, 2.5 steps and all thing. They gave the complete steps to them, the rules were given, but they made the program basically play against each other for more than 60,000 times. So the net learning of the program was 1,20,000 times they have played the game. Then they got the world champion in Go from China to come all the way and basically fight against that. And he lost miserably. And there is a kind of, if you go on YouTube, there's a nice documentary also on this one. You can see this, AlphaGo. It's a big documentary. You can actually see this. I will only show a basic, thing about that one, 2 minutes video, which will explain you what actually happened. This is the AlphaGo documentary, which was basically the game played around that. And here I'll show you a small video on how it worked. It's a very interesting thing because it will basically give you an idea about what happened in AlphaGo. Okay, let me just play this video. Okay. This would be a small ad. I hope you can hear it, right?
We can see your screen showing thanks for using Google Docs.
Okay, 1 minute, just a minute. Okay. Yes, just a minute, I have to share it once again. Yeah, now it is shared.
Human beings have played games against computers. At first, computers struggled, but then they started winning.
What's it? What is greed?
Yes, and now they've become so dominant that they're raising doubts about the future of humanity. The latest emblem to existential dread is Google's DeepMind project, which created AlphaGo, an AI program that's become unbeatable at the most complex strategy game on the planet. While the game of checkers has 10 to the power of 20 possible outcomes, and a game of chess has 10 to the power of 40 possible outcomes, Go has more than 10 to the power of 80 possible outcomes. AlphaGo is trained to analyze situations itself by breaking the game down into tiny parts and visualizing all possible moves. Last week, it played the world's best Go player, 19-year-old Kojin, with the help of a human handler. AlphaGo beat him 3 times, and after doing what it was designed to do, retired from the game.
在这次比赛完之后，在他继续又不停的进步之后，我觉得他对我而言就是100%。
If a system like AlphaGo can learn all the moves in Go well enough to beat a person, then it has the potential to replace lawyers and accountants among dozens of other jobs. It might be perfect, but it has no way to navigate human politics. The Chinese government banned the live stream after Zhe lost the first game. The loss to an American company was an attack on the country's pride.
The Chinese government has made a big effort to proclaim that they are moving ahead rapidly in artificial intelligence, that they will be the people who dominate AI. To have the dreaded Google come in and beat China at its own game, it's just piling insult on top of insult. It's kind of a favor.
But it was more than a national crisis.
So you can actually imagine what kind of things are happening right now. And you saw the word, they didn't ask for any other profession, but I don't like them. They are targeting our profession. They are saying, oh, those guys are there. But yes, there is something very interesting it can do. The problem with humans are we can see things in 2 dimension or maximum 3 dimension. Machines can see this in multiple dimension. This is what machine learning does. It's not going to take over the world like if you have seen these movies like Terminator and all the thing, but it can actually process a lot of data and try to get a feature of all the data. It will say that, oh, I found that most of the data, A plus C is equal to B, a kind of feature extraction. And based on that, it will make its own algorithm program. And it can, you know, make predictive model how the things will move. So it's very interesting how this works. And you may think this is all now sci-fi. You can actually do it in today on TensorFlow, which is from Google, free of cost. You don't have to even make money. So there are three types of machine learning which we can actually do. We have supervised, where are task driven. You can basically use regression and, you know, classification. Unsupervised, where it will basically make our own clustering. It will decide on that. And reinforced, which is nothing but a little bit of information you will give, rest it will make it. But how do we use it? Now that is the point. This is what it is. How we can use it, machine learning, in our audits, and what are the key things we can do? Okay, I'm so sorry. I think this video was not shown. I'll send the link, John. Rashi John, I'll just send the link to you. So sorry. Okay, I'm using a dual monitor, so maybe that's the kind of thing. In Zoom, it doesn't happen at all, but maybe it's okay. I'll just share it out right now. So you can just, you know, maybe search for the term AlphaGo on, you can just search this term AlphaGo. Okay. This is the term you should put it on what we call it as our, you know, YouTube. You can just get it up there. So how we can use it, that's something which is very interesting. This is the things which are there. I'm just talking, when I say forensic engagement, I'm not just talking about banks. I'm not talking about only IBBI. I hope you know there are a lot of forensic engagement which comes from the corporate also. Accounts payable, all these things, what are this? You know, I use the word success stories there because we have done it. We have ourselves done it and we know how we have used it. So we have used it in accounts payable, finding out any revenue leakage or fraud which is happening. Maybe it is the master data of vendors. It can be on revenue where double payment, duplicate payment has been done. Predicting bad debts for an FMCG, we are predicting the bad debts of which customer is going to become a default. Interesting, isn't it? Then spend analytics. How you are doing procurement worldwide, how you are using different vendors are giving you a different price at different point of time. So spend analytics is one thing which we can actually work on, right? General ledger code review, which is basically, especially when ERPs are there like SAP and Oracle, which GL code are being used? Because many times there are wrong GL codes or posting is done, and that can create all big difference out there. So it can be predicted up that this transaction should have happened to this one. Okay. In procurement, contract award, can we identify collusion with the vendors by going through their profiles on social media, all the databases which are there like MC and other things, and try to see if there is any kind of connection between the people, right? Banking, you know, under the Basel III norms, RBI has already asked banks to start predicting non-performing assets and figuring out what is the root cause of that non-performing assets, right? And the most, my favorite one is this one, why I told you is travel and entertainment things. T&E expenditures are the big frauds which happens because it is less in, you know, the value, very small items will be there. And that items, how do we basically deal with that? So those things we need to actually understand, take that forward. You got my point? So here we have all of this, which you can actually use it up. So it will actually help us in even assessment now. Special audits of income tax. I know for sure Bangalore Income Tax Department, they are using a lot of Python scripts to basically predict what are the things which is happening. It's already happening. You know, GST department has already given a big contract to IBM where they are actually going through all the data and trying to predict who is doing what kind of thing. Have you seen that nowadays their success rate has become very good on the fake invoices and all things? They're doing pretty good out there, right? So there are a lot of opportunities of using machine learning and all. So overall, friends, what happens is these are the things which we can do. Using machine learning and data analytics, we can do a pattern analysis. A pattern analysis is nothing but trying to basically see for a pattern, a visual picture when it comes in front of the auditor's eyes, he can see and he can make sense out of that. Have you noticed that for a doctor, we give them you know, ECG, they will see this lines going up and down and they say, oh, everything is okay, everything is not okay. We can also do a pattern analysis based on the financial transactions, how it is going. External data analysis, which is like earlier it was not possible. Machine learning, trying to get a lot of data processed by the machine. Log mining, I'll be showing you, this is called process mining also, which is nothing but trying to see when what information has been processed. A behavioral analysis, whether they are intentionally doing a fraud or it is like kind of thing. Interactive visualization, which is there. Dealing with unstructured data, data from PDFs and other files which are there. And real-time event monitoring, which we can do. The moment a event like this happens, let's take an action on that. Let's try to stop it then and there as we are talking. Okay. Coming to this term log mining or process mining, this is one of the very interesting things which we need to talk about. You all know in our institute material, they have given one very interesting term. What is the impact of computers on audit? And the term is audit trail has blurred. Blurred audit trail. You can't see where what transactions are happening. Now here, what process mining comes into picture. It's a very interesting tool, friends. It is basically trying to see, you know, there is a technique in forensic engagement called space and time dimension. So space dimension is basically we try to see in this much of space, this much item can come. Time dimension is trying to see every transaction at a different point of time and see is there any correlation. Now, this is an example of process mining is an example of time dimension, which is like a proper technique in forensic, which we can actually use and, you know, take it forward. So what I'm trying to do is that you can see there are purchase order, which I'm putting as a case ID. There are activity, create PO, approve PO, receive goods, which are events. There is a timestamp, which is there. Who has done it, that resource is also there, and some other data is being mentioned. Using this, if I feed it into a process mining tools, there are many process mining tools like Celonis and other things. It will give me something like this, that actually the moment there are, you know, POs have been created, 16,000 has been changed, which is not a good thing. And they are being changed multiple times. That is another big issue. And it is giving me that more than 200 instances of manual payment, which is not a good thing for a big company. So all these things are coming when I do a kind of a proper mining of the transactions which are happening. And this, you know, mining allows me to basically see what are the key things which are there and how I would like to deal with that. You got my point, friends? So this is what we are trying to make. Now, coming to the next slide, here is what we talk about, the benefit of process mining. It can help you with resource planning, a proper roles, you know, SOD, who's doing what transactions, identifying bottlenecks, predicting if something has gone wrong, making better decision trees, all that things, it can basically bring it up, okay? So what are the questions which we can help, we can answer using a proper data analytics? So the answer is these three things. Always remember it, a data analytics or audit analytics will help you in terms of checking the hindsight, what happened, insight, why it is happening as a present, and foresight, in future, how do we do that? So hindsight, we clearly say, it is nothing but it is what has happened. Okay, that is what we call it as a hindsight. So in hindsight, we see that, okay, what happened? Insight is, where is the problem? What is the kind of, you know, actions which are needed? Why is this happening? What is the root cause of that? And foresight is, what will happen if this trend continues? If it is going the same way, what will happen next? We need to know. And what are the best we can do to get the maximum out of that? So this is what the answers we can get when we are using analytics properly. You got my point, friends? And you know, always there are some multiple tools and technologies which are there. I have already shared with you, so I'll not go to that. One last slide I would like to discuss with you is this one. Six guiding principles. If you're trying to do analytics, I would not request you to jump that, okay, I now know it, I will go for it. No. Make sure you start simple. Don't try to go for a very big thing initially. Don't try to like say, oh, I'll just go and download nine, this, that, and I'll put a huge amount of data. You need to be comfortable. Start small. That is always the thing. And link your goal and objective with clear business driver. Whatever you are trying to do, we need to do a proper audit planning. What we would like to use, how we'd like to use, and then we should go for that. That is second. Third, you should know your data. Whether your data is clean, not clean, requires some cleaning, all that things we need to look into. And as much as possible, as I told you, your data is the most important resource. If it is a garbage in, then you're going to be garbage out. So we need to take a lot of effort in terms of data. You got my point? Also, we need to leverage existing insight. If already something is there, why to rebuild the, you know, the thing? We should actually try to leverage. So this much is already done. On top of this, what we can do, let's try to see that. Got my point? And make it actionable and measurable. Whatever analytics we are doing, it should be something where people can take some action. They should be able to measure it up. They should be able to take some, you know, key takeaway. It should be useful for them. Got my point? And I would say, please try approach multiple approaches. If you are trying to see something, you can see it in Benish model as well as maybe Penfold together. See what kind of result come here, what kind of result come there. This will give us a complete picture. Okay. To summarize, friends, what we discussed today, I just wanted to give you a kind of a very, very focused point of view on leveraging of data analytics in forensic engagement. And as you know, what kind of forensic engagement we are doing it, fund trail and all things. I talked about first the different types of tools which we can use. And these tools are very important, and we should know how we can actually leverage it. Second, we understood what are the steps which we have to take if we are checking cases of fund trail and related data. Third, we talked about the different concept or steps which are involved, like six steps we talked about, including ETL, how we can actually use those things properly. And then, friends, we discuss about machine learning, how the use cases of machine learning which can be used, what are the different types of way it is being used already, how process mining is also adding value to this, and process mining, how the data can be used in a much better way. Further, we also talked about what is the classification of analytics as hindsight, insight, and foresight, as well as the six guiding principles, which are important from a perspective of understanding and taking it forward. So these are the points which I thought I wanted to share with you. I would now just keep any questions you may have, you know, but only thing which you should remember is when you start using data analytics in your, you know, engagement, you will find one very interesting thing, which we call it as expect the unexpected. You should be prepared for that. You can see this picture here. We have an apple, but what is coming out of apple is going to be you know, what is it? Banana? Banana. Orange. So yeah, that is something which is there. So I would request you to please use all the thing. I'll be sharing this presentation with the brand. Feel free to, you know, let me know anything. Thank you, Joseph. That's all from my side, sir.
Any questions, participants can post in Q&A.
I think there is no question, Anna. I think
no questions in Q&A. Nope.
No problem. It means two things. Either all clear or all clear.
Yeah.
So no problems.
I think this both these topics, I think the data analytics as well as forensic audit, I think it needs to be a little bit more thorough learning is necessary for all of the members, I think.
Yeah.
And I just forgot to mention, somewhere I read that I think our institute itself is coming out with using artificial intelligence for finding out discrepancies in financial statements. Yesterday, I saw a message, news that.
So peer review board is making something on machine learning. I was told also, they asked for some information. The peer review board is there, right, sir? So they are actually trying to do that all the system financial statement, they will feed through into the machine learning model, and they will see which one is coming wrong. So that is their institute using it, so they will use it up.
Yes. So it's a item that, as I mentioned, we should also move in that direction.
Yes.
I mentioned in the morning that, in the beginning, that the COVID has shown us a new way.
Very much, sir.
It's up to us to grab to it, or to utilize it and move forward. So anyway, it's a nice presentation, and a little bit difficult to understand for those who do not have any basic idea about data analytics and forensic auditing. I feel that, I think.
No, sir, I agree with you. That's the reason I'll be sharing this presentation, and my objective was that everyone should try some of the thing and see for themselves what are the things we can use.
Exactly. Anyway, thank you very much. I think that was the personal part. The moment I telephoned to you, you are willing to, without any problem, you agreed for this session.
Great
gesture from your part. We cherish your presence in office programs. Thank you, sir, my personal part. And officially, I request Jose to make the official vote of thanks, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Jangit sir. Thank you very much for that wonderful session on data analysis. In fact, it's going to be the future of our profession. Even we started the income tax department started faceless assessment.
Yes, sir.
And the income tax is the one department which is going ahead with this data analysis. I think they will be using. So we must also know what they will be finding out, or how the data analysis will be a problem for us. So we should be expert on that. So thank you very much for explaining in detail about all the laws, models, theorem, everything on data analysis within a short period of 1.5 hours. Thank you very much. On behalf of Ernakulam branch and all the participants, I extend a sincere thanks to you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir. Roy sir, we will have a break of 10 minutes, then we can be joined.
Incidentally, we will ask Manish Tegi sir, is already there, I think. Good afternoon, sir. Manish sir. Manish sir, can you hear?
Sorry, I was on mute. Yeah, I can hear you.
I think we can straight away proceed with the session, I think.
I am comfortable whatever way. If you want 10 minutes break, I am good with that. We can start after 10 minutes. Whatever way, participants are good with, I am good with.
I think it's better to proceed, I think, because otherwise, I think on a Sunday afternoon, I think people might be feeling to go for some kind of a outing or something, and then it might be a problem.
No, so I can start, not a problem.
Okay, so over to Chairman for welcoming our speaker for FEMA and recent developments.
Yes, this is the second session of this afternoon, which we really wanted to have, because FEMA is an area where I think a lot of inputs needs to be given to the members. I think Manish Tegi sir is a person who is much more involved in enforcement activities also. I think recently in Kerala itself, I think enforcement activities are going on in a much added way on everything. I think not only from our normal transactions, I think the enforcement directors is involving in every activities of MLAs or as well as others also, and going after them, seeking them explanations and all. So the enforcement and as well as the FEMA activities are very much connected, I think. I feel so. So it's in a way very useful for the topic for our members. I think what is happening here the recent days, and what will be our proportions or what is the advice that which can give to our members? That is something which we need to know. I think here the Manish Thangsar is a person who is known to Ernakulam branch. He was here earlier, and we are happy to have him here today. Sir, I think your expertise or your knowledge, your sharing your knowledge will be of very useful to all of us. On behalf of IC Ernakulam branch, I welcome you to this session, sir. Hearty welcome, sir, for your presence today for this session. And I request our members to raise any questions or if anything if they are having during the time of session, and to see that you are also actively participating in these deliberations. Over to Jos, please.
Thank you, Chairman Rogergis. I'm very happy to introduce the speaker of the second session in this afternoon, Advocate Manish Tyagi. He's a corporate and commercial law expertise in corporate and commercial laws, FEMA, ED investigations, regulatory advocacy, M&A, legal due diligence, and employee-related matters. Manish is a partner with MHA Legal. Prior to MHA Legal, he was working with international consultancy firms like PwC, EY, and Deloitte. He has over 20 years of experience in advising international clients on the complex issues related to structuring inbound-outbound investments, mergers and amalgamations, entry strategies, drafting and vetting various commercial agreements, winding up of Indian operations, and conducting legal and regulatory due diligence. He is a very expertise in FMA and investigation initiated by ED, Enforcement Directorate. He is a regular speaker in the seminars organized by various organizations such as CII, ICASI, BRICS, Lex Witness, Legal Era, and Acromic Point, and also in our institute, ICI. With these words, I request our speaker, Advocate Manish Tyagi, sir, to commence the session.
Thank you so much, Mr. Varghese. Thank you so much, Jose, for the kind introduction and the kind words. Of course, I remember, you know, 2-3 years back, or maybe longer, you know, when we kind of interacted in the Ernakulam and then in Kottayam, doing a seminar on the FDI and FEMA. I think that was the subject, or maybe the Companies Act, you know, when the Companies Act was initiated. At that time also we had one seminar on the Companies Act. So thank you so much for calling me again, you know, to give presentation, to share my thoughts to this esteemed organization, and especially, you know, the Ernakulam branch. And I've really always enjoyed, you know, kind of giving my presentation, because, you know, there's a lot of questions asked. I'm sure today also there will be a lot of questions asked, and that kind of stimulate the brain, you know, to some extent. So as you rightly said, you know, Enforcement Directorate has kind of got new teeth, and I will explain in my presentation. I kept that part that, you know, from where they have got those teeth and how they are getting engaged into everything. Because historically, as we see, Enforcement Directorate was the branch which was kind of, you know, created by the Government of India to investigate matters pertinent to Section 3(1) of Foreign Exchange Management Act, which primarily deals with the hawala transaction. But what has happened now is that they are getting involved into everything. So there's a lot of information sharing also that is happening between the departments. Earlier that was not there. Now there's a lot of information sharing also happening. You won't believe, last year I assisted one of my clients in Bangalore. It was a purely domestic company. No export, no import, no overseas investment, no FDI. There was only one matter of export. Still a notice was issued by Enforcement Directorate to that company under Foreign Exchange Management Act. I could not understand how, when a company is not dealing in any of the aspects of Foreign Exchange Management Act, then what are you going to investigate? So I'll explain that when I will come to Enforcement Directorate. So I've divided this, my presentation, into two parts. One is what are the recent developments that has happened in FEMA? What are the things that we need to take care of now? Because right from 2020, if you see the major amendment that has been done, or even, you know, later 2019 and then beginning of 2020 till now, the amendments have been done primarily in export and import of goods and services regulations. Currency regulations for which some amendments have been made. Then there are some amendments which have been made with regard to how to receive money in the ECU mechanism, so that mechanism has been kind of broadened to a great extent. So I will concentrate on export import and then enforcement directorate. Considering the time limit is only 1.5 hours, I'll explain the basic concept and what change has been done. So to start with, I'll just share my presentation. Yeah, you can see my presentation, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if I see, first of all, I would like to cover the foreign direct investment was much talked about. And then I will kind of explain the contract manufacturing also later on, which was also much talked about as far as the Foreign Exchange Management Act is concerned. And there were a lot of claims that were made. So foreign direct investment, as we all know, there was a circular press note 3 of 2020, which was issued by Government of India sometime in April or May. And it basically said that if an investor is coming from any country which shares a land border with India, or where the beneficial ownership of the investment into India is situated in such country, then investment can be made under the common rule. So primarily it was introduced to tackle the Chinese investment, which was overflowing in the country, and they were kind of investing through various means, either directly or indirectly. So this is not something which is new. This was kind of going on in the government for a long time. And if I say that this was going on from past literally 6 months, it will not be an exaggeration of things. But government got a right opportunity in the sense of COVID, and this kind of press note was issued where clearly it was intended to block. Because if I look at the FDI data, there is hardly any investment which we receive either from Bangladesh, from Bhutan, Nepal, or for that matter, Afghanistan and Pakistan. So the country from whom which we receive a major investment and Chinese companies were kind of investing to a great extent into India was into various sectors. I mean, it was into commercial and mining, it was into trading, it was into pharmaceuticals, and that is something which government wanted to protect. So as a result of which, this press note 3 of 2020 was introduced, and after issue of press note 3 of 2020, any investment that is coming from China needs to obtain, I mean, central government approval is required for that. The process is long. We had one matter, where there was a startup in a software sector, and the total agreed rounds were 3 rounds. 2 rounds of funding was already done, and 3rd round of funding was required to be done in 2020, but that got struck. We are still struggling to get the approval. There are, a lot of questions which are asked by Ministry of Home Affairs, by Department of Industrial Policy and Training, which is called Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So it's not easy to obtain that approval if I speak as of today. And if you look at Para 3.1.1b, it basically says that either it is coming from directly or indirectly. So if, let's say, the investment is coming from Hong Kong or Singapore. Singapore is a hub, from where a lot of investment flows into India. So if the investment is coming from Singapore, but it is ultimate beneficial ownership is held by a Chinese entity in a mainland China or in Hong Kong or in anywhere else. And so if I look at from the top of the things, the Chinese entity holds that Singapore entity, and then the Singapore entity is investing into India in any sector that requires prior approval from the government of India. So any client that is coming for investment from these countries, you should ask that client ultimately, what is the hierarchy? What is the overall structure? If structure anywhere shows that even the Chinese national own the beneficial ownership in that entity, then a prior government approval would be required. And accordingly, the time frame should be given if it is an acquisition deal. So one of the important press note 3 of 2020, other was, in defense, the limit was changed from 49% approval route to 100% of FDI was permitted in that, subject to the condition that more than 49% would require government approval. Now that limit of 49% has been changed to 74%. So apart from that, there is nothing much which has happened in 2020, apart from, that we have received a consolidated FDI policy after a period of 3-4 years. But apart from that, if I look at this press note 3 of 2020 was the major press note, which was released by government, and the result is that any investment from Chinese company as of now, either directly or indirectly, require prior approval from the government. So if I move on, as I said, the changes which are done is primarily into export of goods and services. So if I look at from the export of goods and services, what changes have been made? So just to give you a brief background, it is applicable to any export of goods, software or services, the foreign exchange management export of goods and services regulations. Software has been defined to mean any computer program, database, drawing, design, audio, visual signal, or any information by whatever name called, or any medium other than or on an any physical form. So which basically means that if you are not sending it in a physical medium, then everything and anything which is a database, drawing, design, audio signal, or any information will classify as a software. So there is a very broad information, definition that has been given under the export of goods and services regulation. So any exporter of goods software is required to file EDF and SDF soft tax with the evidence containing the true and correct material representing full export value of the goods. So SDF has been discontinued with effect from 2015. Now there are only two forms. One is EDF and one is soft tax. So even if we are exporting software, we need to intimate it under export declaration form. So we need to intimate it under soft tax, and any physical movement of goods, which is not a software, that needs to be intimated under export declaration form. So what is important is that we need to give a full export value of goods and software. And if the full export value is not ascertainable at the time of export, then whatever market value, considering the prevailing market condition that is available, that we need to put in the EDF. In the event export proceeds are proposed to be realized from third parties, it should be adequately declared in the declaration forms. So this question is often asked, you know, whenever we discuss export of goods and services, that, you know, that export that is only applicable to export of goods and software, where it is written that it is applicable for services as well. So if an Indian company is providing services to an overseas entity and exporting services, then where it is written. So Regulation 3.3 of export of goods and services very clearly provide that. And this is kind of clarification which has been given by Reserve Bank of India, which says that for the removal of doubt, it is clarified that in respect of export of services to which none of the forms specified in the regulation apply, the export may export such services without furnishing any declaration, but shall be liable to realize the amount of foreign exchange which becomes due or accrue on account of such export, and to repatriate the same into India in accordance with the provisions of the Act and these regulation and also other rules regulation made under that. So it's very clear that for software, for services, for export of goods and software, we need to file EDF and soft tax respectively, whatever is applicable. However, for services, we do not need to file any form. A copy of the invoice along with copy of the contract would suffice. But as far as the condition with regard to realization is concerned, that is something which is applicable on services. So the moment we raise the invoice, the date of invoice, specify the time period of 9 months or 6 months, whatever is applicable for export and import. Move ahead. As I said, form prescribed was primarily EDF and soft tax. EDF is for declaration of export of goods and software through physical means and non-electronic data interchange EDI codes, and soft tax needs to be filed for export of software through electronic means. Now, this is the change which has been done. I mean, yes, we all know that prior to prior to 2020, the exports, any export value or any export made, the full export value was required to be, you know, realized within a period of 9 months. However, this period has been extended up to any export that has been made by July 31st, 2020. The period has been extended to 15 months. So any export that has been made up to July 31st, 2020, the time period applicable would not be 9 months, the time period applicable would be 15 months. Accordingly, we need to calculate for the previous year. So let's say even if I have exported any goods, let's say in last November, then the time period applicable on the export on the November goods would be 15 months, not 9 months. But anything after July 31st, 2020, the period of 9 months would be applicable. And any export prior, and that export would not qualify for the 15 months period. So this year we need to calculate accordingly and see that we are not in non-compliance of the foreign exchange management export of goods and services regulation. As we all know, RBI has launched EPDMS and IPDMS for export and import respectively, and any non-compliance is automatically highlighted. RBI is also sending regular emails to the exporter citing that, you know, you have not file either a bill of entry or it has not been realized. The delegation has also been given to the ED banks, who kind of regularly remind that these are all the bill of entries against which you need to realize the amount, but that has not been realized in a period of 9 months. So we need to be very careful while we look at the realization period, especially for this year, where for some invoices or some export of goods, it would be 15 months, and for some it would be 9 months. Advance, there is no change in advance. Advance needs to be settled within a period of 12 months only. Payment can be received in freely convertible foreign exchange, Indian rupee, or through ACU mechanism. So, you know, this query is also kind of raised several times as to, you know, whether if I have exported to a foreign entity, then can I receive that money in an Indian rupee? Will it qualify under the definition of foreign exchange? Then the regulation very clearly provides that any export which has been done can be realized in a foreign currency, can be realized in Indian currency, or can also be realized through the Asian Clearing Unit union mechanism. So either of the three we can use and kind of, you know, do it. So even if the foreign our foreign client is kind of converting that money outside India in rupee and then sending Indian rupee, exact Indian rupee, into India, that will also qualify as a foreign exchange, and that will be treated towards the full realization, full export value of the goods that has been realized. Now, if you look at, so there were two options which were given to the Indian exporter. Either he can export it directly to the foreign customer, or we are, you know, in situations, for example, in a complex contract where a lot of machinery, a lot of parts were required outside India, then an option was given that you can open a warehouse, an Indian exporter can open a warehouse outside India. The period for the warehouse was 15 months, and that has not been changed. This was clarified because people were kind of raising a query when initially on 31st March the circular was issued, what will happen to the warehouse? Then later on 1st of April, and later on, you know, RBI kind of clarified that this period is not changed, it will remain 15 months. So this is also one of the question, no change on this aspect, everything remains the same. So the question is asked that if, let's say, an Indian exporter is exporting services to a foreign importer, and open a foreign currency account, and foreign importer gives, you know, that payment into the foreign currency account directly, and later on that payment is transferred from a foreign currency account to an Indian currency account, then is it possible? So this whole model is not possible. This whole model require a prior approval from Reserve Bank of India. If any of this type of models are adopted, or there is a business plan to adopt this, please please take appropriate clarifications from RBI, because these type of models are not approved, and these are not, you know, under the automatic route from the Reserve Bank of India perspective. The only exception to this is that, you know, where an SEZ unit can open a foreign currency account, or where there is a participation with the international exhibition trade fair, then the temporary foreign currency account can be open. RBI approval, specific RBI approval, it can be opened with the AD bank, either India and outside India. Project to service exporter can hold and maintain foreign currency account with a bank outside India. And export proceeds which are received in EFC account, which is very usual. These are the only exceptions. Apart from that, the plain and simple model, if this type of model is adopted. Well, I had a client, and I had a, you know, kind of, I've seen this type of, you know, structures implemented practically. And in this case, what happened was that Indian exporter opened a foreign currency account in name of its project office outside India. And whatever he was exporting to his foreign client, the payment was received by their project office, and that project withdraw whatever amount, and then they used to send it to the Indian bank account. This created a huge problem from the FEMA perspective. Even the ED got involved, and overall, I mean, the matter is still pending with RBI. Even after 3 years, approval has not been obtained. But these type of structures, if they are implemented, prior approval should be obtained. Third party payment, no payment has been, no change has been made. It's more or less remains the same, that if an Indian exporter, instead of receiving it from the FO1, it will be receiving it from the FO2 from a third party, then a firm or irrevocable order backed by a tripartite agreement should be in place. The exporter should declare the third party remittance in EDF, and third party needs to be routed through the banking channels only. So this is permitted, no change has been made to this. Now, direct dispatch of shipping documents, this is something, you know, which has been changed very recently by way of a circular dated December 4, 2020. Earlier, what used to happen was that in case where exporter used to, you know, kind of directly dispatch the shipping documents to the consignee or his agent resident in a country or the final destination or anywhere of goods up to $3 million or its equivalent per export shipment, that was permitted. But now this limit of $1 million has been removed, and henceforth AD Bank can regularize such direct dispatch of shipping documents irrespective of value of the shipment, subject to the conditions that export proceeds have been realized in full except with the amount written off in accordance with the exempt provisions of write-off. Exporter is a regular customer of the AD Bank. The exporter account with the AD Bank is fully compliant, and AD Bank is satisfied about the bona fide of the mission. So the change is that $1 million limit, which was earlier applicable for direct dispatch of shipping document, that has been removed by RBI. Write-off, so write-off limits have not been changed. Write-off more or less remains the same. The self-write-off of 5% by an exporter, self-write-off by certified exporter 10%, and write-off of authorized dealer bank 10%. The limit has not been changed, but what has been clarified that the limits of self-write-off and write-off of AD Bank shall be reckoned cumulatively. So earlier there was no as such, you know, clarification that was given by RBI that how you will treat these two, this thing, can we add up, can we not add up. So that has been put to rest by RBI, and it has been very clearly specified now that they will be reckoned cumulatively. The documentation remains the same, that we need to submit a chartered accountant certificate indicating the export realization in the preceding calendar year. Also, any amount write-off is already available in the year. We need to give the EDF, what needs to be, which bill number, what invoice number. So documentation, there's nothing has been changed, only one clarification which has been added. Also, the conditions which were attached permitting the write-off also remains the same. And it is very clearly provided that write-off would be permitted only where first condition is that the amount has remained outstanding for a period more than 1 year. Second is that the satisfactory evidence is furnished in support of exporter having made all efforts to realize its dues, and the case should fall in any one of the categories. And that category could be that the overseas buyer had declared insolvent and a certificate from the official liquidator has been obtained. Overseas buyer is not traceable reasonably long period of time. The goods exported have been auctioned, destroyed by post-custom health authorities in the import country. The unrealized import represents the balance due in settlement due to the intervention of Indian Embassy, Chamber of Commerce, such organization. The unrealized amount represents the undrawn balance of the export bill, not exceeding 10% of the value. The cost of resorting to legal action would be disproportionate to the unrealized amount. So it is mandatory whenever an application for write-off. So the question is asked that if we are not falling in these limit, 5% and 10% limit, then what we should do? If we are kind of looking at a 100% write-off, or if we are looking at any write-off which is more than 10%, we need to file an application with the Reserve Bank of India regional branch with all the data with regard to why we are asking for it. And it is very important that our case should fall in any of these things. I mean, 1 year has passed, all efforts are made, and then any of these conditions are complied with, then only, you know, there is a possibility that write-off approval would be obtained. An application needs to be filed through AD Bank. AD Bank will kind of add its comment, whatever, you know, that needs to be done, and post that application will be forwarded to the regional branch. Usually the practice in the regional branch is the regional branch will forward it to the central branch, and only once, you know, approval is obtained from the central branch, then it will be communicated. But approval are granted for the genuine cases. We have obtained, there was one case, you know, in which 2009 onwards there was a due or write-off very recently, just before the COVID period, that matter was approved. So there is no as such problem. If there is, it is long overdue, you can go and file an application for write-off. Now these are the two things, you know, which has been added by RBI specifically with effect from December 4, 2020, and it has been said that for the two cases, write-off facility would not be available. Country export made to countries with externalization problem, that is where overseas buyer has deposited the value of goods in local currency, but the amount has not been allowed to be repatriated to central bank authorities of the country concerned. The country in question here is Iran. So what has happened is that the Iran government is not allowing any money to be withdrawn from the bank account of Iran to any other country. So last year we had a case where there was a huge sum of amount a Japanese company has kind of, you know, get into a joint venture with a foreign entity, and after that, after the project was completed, you know, the joint venture entity, they have, and as a result of it, you know, for that project they have given a huge deposit to the Iranian government. But when an application was filed with the Iran government saying that, and anyway, there were a lot of, you know, US restrictions, there are a lot of WTO restrictions, the Iran is not in FATF, so there are a lot of issues anyway. And for that, you know, approval was required. So the Japanese company's plan was that they will withdraw that amount from Iran and will invest in the Indian JV. But Iran government very clearly declined, saying that we will not permit this, as this is a Iranian money and this needs to be utilized only in Iran. So if the export is made to such countries and the money has got stuck there, the right of facility would not be available. And the second one is that where EDF Softex, which are under investigation by Enforcement Directorate, Director of Revenue Intelligence, Central Bureau of Investigation, etc., or outstanding bill subject to civil or criminal suit, for these matters also write-off would not be available. Then there are sundry conditions that, you know, write-off would be kind of, AD Bank will manage it through export data processing and monitoring system, EPDMS, and AD Bank shall pay the system carry out a random check, and you know, if any approval is required, the matter would be forwarded to the regional bank. Now netting off also, for setting off also there are some changes which has been done. Presently, you know, for so there was one of the fundamental question which was asked for the netting off is that I have a service export and a goods import. Can I do a write-off? Where, you know, I have imported goods and I have provided services. So to even to the same buyer and seller, so is it possible that I can do a write-off? The question earlier was no, but it was not written anywhere. And it used to cause a lot of confusion and people used to go to RBI specifically asking for it. AD Bank, if you look at the bullet point one, has very clearly said, no, sorry, this is not falling here. I just come. Yeah, so if you look at the fourth bullet point, it says set off of export receivable against good shall not be allowed against import payable for services and vice versa. So RBI has kind of put a full stop to this query or this condition that, you know, can we do this? Now it is not possible. So goods can be set off against good, service can be set off against services, but inter se they cannot be netted off. So another question which used to ask was that in the condition of netting off, which was permitted by RBI earlier, was that the export receivable against the outstanding import payable should be from the same overseas buyer and supplier. But there were a lot of things, you know, because of the centralized settlement system, which majority of the MNCs follow, what used to happen was that that write-off request, netting off request used to come from the Indian exporter or exporter saying that, you know, with the overseas group company or associate company, we should be allowed a set off either on a net basis or a gross basis, because the settlement is done through an in-house centralized settlement arrangement. Earlier, these type of requests were rejected by RBI, but with effect from December 4, 2020, it has been specifically permitted. And it has said that, you know, AD Bank can consider that that request subject to the condition that that the arrangement is operationalized, supervised through one AD Bank. The bank is satisfied with the bona fide of the transaction and ensure there is no KYC, AML or CFCT non-compliances. The invoices are not under any investigation. Import has been done in accordance with the extant foreign trade policy. The export-import transaction with the ECU countries are kept outside the arrangement. Set off for export receivable against goods shall not be allowed against export payable for services and vice versa. I think this is the most important part which we are discussing at present. AD Bank shall ensure that import, export, payable, receivable are outstanding at the time of allowing of set off. Further set off shall be allowed between exporter and importer leg taking place during the same calendar year. In case of a bilateral settlement, the set off shall be in respect of same overseas buyer supplier subject to it being supported by verifiable agreement, mutual consent. Then there are other conditions that, you know, if there are group company, associate company, the arrangement shall be backed by a written legally enforceable contract, which will ensure that, you know, all the terms of the agreement are strictly adhered to. It should not result in any tax avoidance. Third parties should be audited by the concerned entities wherever applicable. AD Bank shall ensure compliance with all regulatory requirements, and AD Bank may seek an auditor or CA certificate wherever felt necessary. So, if all these conditions are complied with, then a netting off would be permitted by the AD Bank without forwarding the application to Reserve Bank of India. Practically, that doesn't work out. Any application for netting off which is filed with the AD Bank kind of gives its positive comments to it, and ultimately, it forwards it to the regional bank for an approval. And only once the approval is received, then only netting off is permitted. But yeah, I mean, as I said, these two conditions. First is that export receivable against goods is not allowed and vice versa. And second is that setup shall be allowed between export and import legs taking place during the same calendar year. These are the two most important changes which has been done with regard to, you know, the present netting of situation, present netting of conditions that were there in place. The refund of export proceeds, earlier it was allowed that goods exported to India or re-imported into India on account of poor quality, then refund should be permitted. But the fundamental condition there was that goods which are exported should be received in India. In case goods were not received in India or destroyed due to poor quality by the concerned custom authorities or by port authorities, then that was something which was not permitted. And it was always insisted that you should go and obtain EDF waiver before such kind of request is kind of entertained by the AD Bank. But that has been changed and it has been permitted that henceforth, while that in the case the goods exported have been auctioned or destroyed by in the importing country, then AD Banks can permit the refund of export proceeds of the goods exported from India, provided, you know, the due diligence is obtained, one of our transactions is kind of verified by the AD Bank. A certificate is issued by a DGFT custom authority that no export incentive has been availed by the exporter against the relevant export proportionate to export relief. If it has been surrendered, or you know, if it has not been, if it has been availed, then it has been surrendered. Then the AD Bank will not insist henceforth that the import should happen of those goods where this goods have been destroyed by the post or custom authorities, an appropriate letter or any, you know, or any other accredited agency. Submit a satisfactory document to that effect. So that is primarily, you know, refund of export proceeds. So the underlying thing is that if the goods are kind of destroyed by the port or custom or the health authorities outside India, and it is not possible to kind of import it back into India, then in that case, AD Banks will not raise objections and AD Banks will permit refund of amount which was received for export of such goods. Now, if you look at import of goods and services, no major change has been done, except the same change which has done for the export is that all import transactions needs to be settled within a period of 15 days, within a period of 12 months instead of 6 months, which is made before July 31st, 2020. So for export, it has been made 15 months, and for import it has been made 12 months. So any import which has been done prior to July 31st, 2020, that import will qualify for the payment mechanism up to 12 months, so not the 6 months which was earlier applicable. Rest all remains the same. There is no change which has been done, which is like deferred payment or whatever. Now, deferred payment, I would like to touch base because there's a lot of questions which are raised. So deferred payment arrangement, so there's a difference between an import transaction and an import transaction on a deferred payment basis. Deferred payment basis import transaction primarily mean that right in the beginning, the importer and the exporter both are agreeing that instead of making the payment within a period of 6 months, we will make the payment, let's say, within a period of 3 years. So those type of transactions would need to comply with the trade credit guidelines given under the external commercial borrowings. Any transaction which is a normal import transaction, and let's say in the import documentation it is written that the payment would be made within a period of 6 months, or Indian company will receive the payment within a period of 6 months or 2 months or 3 months, that need not to comply with the deferred payment, so that need not to comply with the trade credit, even if payment is delayed due to commercial reasons. So if you look at the master direction, there are two aspects which have been written. One is says that if it is delayed due to disputes, financial difficulties for a period less than 3 years from the date of shipment, you can receive, you can go and obtain a specific approvals from Reserve Bank of India, which can be granted up to a period of 3 months. I mean, if you go and file an application, generally it is given for a period you have specified. So for example, if I file an application saying that I need an extension for a period of another year or 18 months, whatever, that extension would be granted. But beyond 3 years, if something, you know, which is kind of questioned even by RBI. So AD Bank can grant up to 3 years, and beyond 3 years require specific approval from RBI. But that does not qualify for a deferred payment arrangement. Deferred payment arrangements are only those transactions where right in the beginning, by way of executing a contract, it has been agreed that the payment would not be made within a period of 6 months, but the payment would be made only after a period of, let's say, 18 months or 24 months or 36 months, whatever. So that is the difference between a normal import transactions and an import transaction on a deferred payment arrangement, which needs to comply with the trade credit as specified in the external commercial borrowing agreements. Rest all remain the same. As I am saying, that extension of time is for the interest of the listeners. I have kept it. AD banks have been granted the power to, you know, kind of grant an extension of time for any import transactions for a period less than 3 months. So for a period less than 3 years from the date of shipment or invoice, extension beyond 3 years requires specific approval from Reserve Bank of India. All these conditions needs to be complied with. Saying that, so one of the important aspect is that it should not be under investigation by Enforcement Directorate or CBI or other investigation agencies. Then remittance does not exist USD 1 million or 10% of the average import proceeds remittance during the preceding two financial years, whichever is lower. An extension of time is reported under the IPDMS system. Third argument, there is no change. Same as export, the import can also be done. I've just kept it. So that, you know, these sometimes, you know, questions are raised on third party payment, but there's no as such change, you know, in the regulations. Now, this was a new guidelines which was issued for the merchanting trade high sales, high sea sales. And there were a lot of transactions which were done, and you know, there was a lot of displeasure that was a lot of comments were given to RBI saying that the existing merchanting trade high sea sales guidelines put the Indian importer or exporter is kind of, you know, in a space where he is not able to exercise the rights that are, you know, kind of availed or the benefits that are availed by the other countries, exporter or importer. So that's why there was a need to change the guidelines, and with effect from January 23rd, 2020, new merchanting trade high sea sales guideline has been introduced by the Reserve Bank of India. But if you look at the guidelines, there is no change. I didn't see any change. See, one of the major issue was that the merchanting trade transaction used to commence from the date of shipment of export leg or receipt of import leg payment, whichever was first. And the same condition still appears in the revised guidelines as well. And the total time period which has been given is 12 months still, 1 year. Within 1 year, both the export and import transaction needs to be completed. So for the simple transaction of a merchanting trade where, you know, goods is coming from one country and while in transit sold to another country and everything is settled within a period of 1 year, that is perfectly fine. There is no issue with that. But in a complex transaction where good is going from one country to another and from another to another, that is something, you know, which is still not kind of covered in the merchant trade high sea sales guidelines, and it still remains a question mark. As you know, as I need to complete the merchant trade transaction within over a period of 9 months, and there cannot be any outlay of foreign exchange beyond 4 months. So the kind of disadvantage which you used to talk earlier is still there. There's no change as such. You can go through this, or I can also explain. I mean, as I'm saying, if you look at the bullet, fourth bullet from the top, I mean, of course, the standards are that, you know, all rules and regulation with regard to export and import has been complied. AD banks are satisfied with regard to bona fide transactions, compliance with the KYC and AML guidelines. The entire merchant transaction is routed through the same AD bank. The commencement date, the entire merchant trade transaction needs to be completed within an overall period of 9 months, and there shall not be any outlay of foreign exchange beyond 4 months. the commencement date of merchandise trade shall be first, shall be the date of shipment of export leg receipt or import leg payment, whichever is first. The completion date shall be the date of shipment or export leg receipt or import leg payment, whichever is the last. So this is basically the time period where I need to calculate between the fourth, between the fifth bullet and the sixth bullet. Short-term credit by way of supplier credit, buyer credit may be extended by MDT, but LOU, LOC will not be issued to supplier or buyer credit. Any receipt of the export leg prior to payment of import leg may be parked either in EFC account or the non-interest bearing INR account till the import leg liability arises, and it shall be clearly earmarked, lien marked for the payment of import leg, and the liability of import leg as soon as it arises shall be extinguished out of this fund without any delay. So even if I have done an export and amount has been raised, amount has been received, I cannot use that amount for my commercial purposes, as I have to keep it specifically lien marked for my import leg payment. If that payment is kept in an interest bearing NR account, hedging thereof will be allowed by every bank at the request of the customer. No fund based fund, no fund, non fund based facility shall be extended these balances, which basically means I cannot take any loan. Merchandise trade may be allowed, merchandise traders may be allowed to make advance payment for the import leg on demand made by the supplier. However, any payment made for an import leg beyond $500,000 per transaction shall be made against the bank guarantee. Unconditionally irrevocable standard letter of credit from an international bank of repute. Letter of credit to the supplier for the import leg is permitted against confirmed export order, keeping in view the exchange outlay of 4 months and completion of merchandise trade transaction within a period of 9 months, subject to compliance with the instructions issued by DBOD on the guarantees and acceptance as amended from time to time. AD bank shall ensure 1-to-1 matching in case of each merchandise trade transaction and report defaults in any leg by the traders to the concerned regional office of the Reserve Bank on half yearly basis on the format prescribed. Merchant traders with outstanding of 5% or more of the annual export earnings shall be liable for cautious listing. So if you look at, you know, these guidelines as when I compare it with the guidelines which were applicable last year, there's no change. In fact, these have been become more stringent, where I need to, you know, lien mark my amount into a separate bank account and I cannot use it for the commercial purposes, as I have to, you know, use it only for payment of import leg. And once the import leg payment is made, whatever left, that only I can use it for my normal business operations. So contract manufacturing, as I said, you know, this is the most talked about subject, and there are a lot of, you know, questions that were raised. But as I've said in earlier programs which I have done, you know, with regard to export and import of goods and services regulation, I say that till the time export and import of goods and services regulations are not changed, contract manufacturing in India would remain a distant dream. You know, during the COVID time, there was a lot of speculation that was made that India can, you know, kind of take place of China, and there are, you know, a lot of stuff which you can do through contract manufacturing. But unfortunately, none of that is a reality. The first condition is that, you know, if you look at China has created a specific SEZs for exports, and those 4 or 5 SEZs which have been created in mainland China kind of, you know, take care of more than 80% of the exports which are done, or maybe 90% of the exports that are done by China. The simple thing is that there is no rules or regulation that are applicable to them. Complete freedom is given, except, you know, the condition with regard to that you need to pay your employees and you need to do all that stuff, and the basic environmental clearances that needs to be obtained. Apart from that, the SEZ is free to do whatever it wants to do with regard to payments, receipt of payment, making of payment, whatever, and manufacturing of products. 24-hour shift is also possible. We have a lot of concerns. I mean, that is a different thing, you know, from the labor law perspective. But if you look at purely from the foreign exchange management perspective, whether contract manufacturing is permitted, I will say no. As of today, if you look at, there are a lot of issues with regard to receipt of. So, for example, I'll give you a very, this is slightly still complex, but if I give you a very simple example of contract manufacturing where company A is sitting outside India and it wants to get a product made in India, product made in India, and raw material for that product needs to be obtained from company C, which is again outside India. And company A says to the company B that, you know, you supply this raw material to the Indian entity free of cost, and I will make that payment to you. And as a result of which, whenever, you know, payment is made by A to B for the contract, A to the Indian company for the contract manufacturing, then in that case, you know, he kind of deduct the raw material cost from the overall services. So would it be permitted? I mean, if you look at, so that is something which is not permitted as of now. The moment you will import any raw material from a company outside India, you need to, you are immediately obliged to make the payment towards the import within a period of 6 months. Whenever the export is made, you need to realize the full export value of the goods. So you cannot minus the free of cost raw material that has been received. So these are the type of, you know, challenges that are faced by the while doing the contract manufacturing, and that is something, you know, which has not been permitted specifically by Reserve Bank of India. I mean, every time an exporter cannot go for, or a contract manufacturer cannot go to RBI for obtaining approval, and there is no general permission that has been given by RBI on this. So if you look at this model, there is an Indian contractor, contract manufacturer C, which has got into a contract to manufacture goods with a foreign manufacturer A, and foreign manufacturer A has a sourcing company again situated outside India, and the sourcing company and it kind of, you know, gives a contract for sourcing of X raw material, X raw material, and invoice and payment is settled between manufacturer A and the sourcing company. Sourcing company looks at you know, from where the raw material is available and find that the raw material is available cheapest in India. So it orders the supply to, you know, the raw material to company C, which is again based in India. So if I look at it from the raw material supplier perspective, the raw material supplier and Indian manufacturer C both are situated in India. And as a result of which, Indian manufacturer C received this raw material from the Indian material supplier, and then it kind of supply the finished goods to group company B as per the contract that has been given by foreign manufacturer A. However, invoice it to the foreign manufacturer and receive the payment for doing the manufacturing services in India from foreign manufacturer. Now the question is that even the A and B can be the payment and kind of, you know, this thing can be covered in the third party transaction. But the problem is that the cost of raw material would not be included here. The moment we will export the goods, there will be a question by the customs authority saying that this does not represent the full export value of the goods, because raw material has been minused. Has been minus from the purchase of goods. So for example, if I'm making a mouse and everything has been given to me and I'm just, you know, kind of putting only service fee for manufacturing of this mouse, the other components which have been received free of cost by me, I will not include that in my invoice. And immediately, you know, question will be raised that this is under invoicing, which has been done by you. And accordingly, you know, you are kind of either stealing, either, you know, kind of you are not disclosing the correct value, and as a result of which there is a loss which has been made to the Indian government with regard to custom duties or whatever. So there are a lot of questions which will be raised in this manner. The problem becomes more severe when this raw material supplier is situated outside India, as I was explaining in my earlier example. So until unless there are appropriate changes that has been made under the Export of Goods and Services Regulation, where the contract manufacturing is specifically permitted, or a guidelines for the contract manufacturing is permitted, then this is something, you know, which is a possibility that can happen in India. Otherwise, it's a distant dream. SEZs have not been that effective. First of all, manufacturing SEZs are only you know, located in few areas. They are not that widespread. But the manufacturing happens all over India. And till the time in a domestic tariff area, clear guidelines are not issued as to how you can do this, the question will remain negative and we may not be able to take the place of China as we are kind of thinking for a long period of time. So I'll discuss this because there was a lot of contract manufacturing thing which was throughout the year 2020. We have kept hearing that, you know, India will become a hub, India will become this, India will become that. But if it is a pure and simple, you know, kind of import order and export invoice, then it is okay. But if it is, you know, kind of a complex situation where free of cost raw material is given or any other kind of, you know, help is provided by the foreign manufacturer, then it creates a lot of problems. So this is primarily with regard to the export and import of goods and services regulation. If you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, we can take questions towards the end of the presentation. So if you look at, so we'll move on to investigations by the Enforcement Directorate. Now, if you look at in the previous 1 year, as I was saying in the beginning, Enforcement Directorate has started to pick up a lot of matters as compared to the But you know, if I compare from 15, 16 or 16, 17 onwards, from 2018 onwards, you're suddenly seeing the enforcement director is very active, kind of investigate each and every aspect related to foreign exchange. Earlier it was only hard transaction, but now there are any transaction which has been done under foreign exchange, the notices are received. Even if it is an if it is a smuggling matter, you know, even in that, enforcement directorate kind of raises a question and calls people for info, for giving the information and to look at that, you know, if any money laundering regulations have not have been kind of violated by doing these type of smuggling or whatever. So all these things, why these are happening, how enforcement directorate has got this power, I'll just explain in this in next half an hour, 45 minutes time. So if you look at the very basic broad framework, then under Foreign Exchange Management Act, Chapter 6, Section 36 to 38, relate to establishment and powers of the Enforcement Directorate. And the Enforcement Directorate basically enforces two law. One is the Foreign Exchange Management Act, which is a civil law having a quasi-judicial powers for investigating suspected contraventions of the foreign exchange control laws, and regulations with regard to power to impose penalty on those liability, and a Prevention of Money Laundering Act, which is a criminal law, whereby the officers are empowered to conduct inquiries to locate provisionally attached, confiscate attached derived from such acts or schedule of offenses, besides arresting and prosecuting any money launderers. So Foreign Exchange Management, as I said, is a civil law, but that has been given a shape of criminal as of now, if I, you know, kind of to say that. And why it is so, I'll just explain you in the further slides. So power of ED is to collect, develop, disseminate intelligence relating to violations of Foreign Exchange Management Act. Intelligence inputs are received from various sources such as central and state investigation agencies, complaints file, income tax department, Benami properties, foreign currency account, which has been disclosed by the foreign jurisdictions to the Indian government. So from that is primarily from where the information is collected. The information also collected from Reserve Bank of India for with regard to any export and import transaction. Primarily, you know, ED was kind of, you know, established to investigate suspected violations relating to hawala transaction, or foreign exchange secretary, non-realization of export, non-repatriation of foreign exchange, other form of violation under Foreign Exchange 1999. Now, if you look at the trade-based money laundering, so there are two questions which are asked. Why ED is involved in all matters? So if that is, if I say that why ED is involved and from where they get the power, that is section, if you look at section 13, so there are no amendment which have been done post 2018, and ED has been given vast power under the section 13. I'll just explain you this. So if you look at the trade-based money laundering, why they are involved. So as far as ED is concerned, ED thinks that there are three main methods by which criminal organization and terrorist organization can move money for the purpose of disguising its origin or integrating it into the formal economy by using a financial system, the movement of money through the cash courier, which is primarily hawala, and third is through the physical movement of goods through the trade system. Now this is something which kind of ED tries to investigate whenever there is any mismatch in the trade documents or there is any mismatch in the amount. So trade-based money laundering is defined as the purpose of disguising the proceeds of crime and moving value through the use of trade transaction and attempt to legitimize their illicit origins. In practical, this can be achieved through misrepresentation of the price, quantity or quality of import and export. And trade-based money laundering techniques vary in complexity and are frequently used in combination with the other money laundering techniques to further obscure any money trails. So just to explain you this, I'll just push on. And then I will come back to this. If you look at this, this is a simple case of an under invoicing. So if you look at this, there is a company registered in a home country, India, and there is a company registered in a foreign country. The contract is to kind of give a widget, you know, any it could be anything, it could be a simple calculator. So let's say if it is a simple calculator and it has been agreed between both the companies that, you know, it will be given at the rate of $1 from foreign country to the home country, from company A to company I. So whereas the actual price is $2. So what company E will do is that company E will kind of, you know, will give the widgets to the company A. The home country will make the payment to the company E for only $1 million at the rate of $1 each. and the rest of $2. And in the home country, they will sell it at the price of $2 because the original value is $2. That the remaining amount of 1 million that can be disposed of by company I in accordance with the direction that has been given by company P. So it's a very simple example, but if you look at this, this becomes complex. Because then what happens is that there is an extra $1 million which is coming into the economy and that can be used by this company I for anything which is directed by the company E. And company E may ask you to do a hawala, company E may ask you to do to kind of set up some other liabilities of company E in India, whatever. So that is where this under-invoicing and over-invoicing part of stuff is investigated. And that's why these days, if you would have seen, there is a if there is any amount which is pending in the EPDMS or IPDMS system, which is more than 20 crore, immediately ED becomes interested in that matter to see that there is no under-invoicing and over-invoicing and money has not been moved through a hawala transaction. That's why all these trade transactions are kind of investigated by the ED. The smuggling matters are also, you know, same thing. In Kerala, as there are a lot of, you know, gold biscuits that were being bought from the Middle East countries from outside India, and that has been seized by them. The question remains the same, that, you know, person who is getting the gold into the Indian country, how he has made the payment. That is the first question. The second question is that, let's say if he has not made the payment, then how he was receiving that money in India, to whom he was giving. So the third party to whom, let's say if he was only a carrier, then to the ultimate beneficiary, how he has made the payment. Because if he would have made the payment through normal banking channels, then the gold would not have been coming from through the smuggling means. The another thing is that, let's say if the gold is kind of coming into India by illegal means, then who is the ultimately beneficiary, how it is going to, you know, implement overall economy, how it is going to, you know, define that, you know, whether the banking channels are used or not used. So these are all the things which are kind of, you know, investigated by the enforcement directorate. So from where they get the power? Section 39 will come later, but there was a new section 37A, which was kind of, you know, introduced by the Finance Act of 2018, if I'm not wrong. And with the effect from Finance Act of 2018, section 37A was inserted in the Foreign Exchange Management Act. And there was a special provision related to assets outside India and contravention of section 4 was given. And the section says, upon receipt of any information or otherwise, if the authorized officer prescribed by the central government has reason to believe that any foreign exchange, foreign security, or any immovable property situated outside India is suspected to have been held in contravention of section 4, he may, after recording the reasons in writing by an order, seize value equivalent situated in India of such foreign exchange, foreign security, or immovable property, provided that no such seizure shall be made in case where the aggregate value of foreign exchange, foreign security, or immovable property situated outside India is less than the value as prescribed. The value which has been prescribed by the central government is 1 crore. The order of seizure along with relevant material shall be placed before the competent authority appointed by the central government, who shall be an officer not below the rank of joint secretary of the government of India by the authorized officer within a period of 30 days from the date of such seizure. On receipt of application to this regard from the aggrieved person and after recording an opportunity of being heard by the aggrieved person in representation to representation of director of enforcement shall pass an approved order as been deemed fit, including setting aside the seizure made under subsection 1. Any person aggrieved by the order passed by the order authority may appeal to the appellate tribunal. Nothing under section 15 shall apply to this section. So if you look at section 37A, the wording of it, it very clearly says that upon receipt of any information or otherwise, if the information is received, well and good. If it is a self-generated information, that will also suffice. So if an enforcement directorate is the authorized officer as far as Foreign Exchange Management Act is concerned, So from section 37A, they primarily derive their power to investigate any foreign exchange, movement of any foreign exchange, movement of any foreign security or any immovable property. ED has, in fact, 2 years back, you know, I was doing one matter in Chandigarh and it was related to a non-resident Indian. And that non-resident Indian has purchased a property outside India under the liberalized remittance scheme somewhere in 2005, 2006. And considering he hold that property, which has a significant value outside India, that was shared by the foreign government under the information sharing scheme with the Indian government. And as a result of which, it was shared with the Income Tax Department. The Income Tax Department passed on that information to the Enforcement Directorate. Enforcement Directorate issued a notice to the NRI saying that, you know, this property belongs to you and you should explain as to why. And they had a branch, you know, a kind of, you know, Indian company here, and that's how the notice was served to him. But, you know, later on when it was showed that, you know, property was kind of purchased under the liberalized remittance scheme and aduquot document, luckily he had that aduquot document with him, then, you know, the case was dropped. Otherwise, you know, if you doubt not have the document, he would have assumed that he has purchased it, you know, by illegal means, and unnecessary, you know, problem would have been created. So this is primarily Section 37A from the powers of ED are coming. Earlier, the power was given only with regard to Section 3.1 Hawala Transaction, for Section 3.1 of the Foreign Exchange Management Act. But now it can be related to any foreign exchange, foreign security, or any immovable property. So it's very clear for each and everything, any foreign exchange related regulation, ED can investigate that matter. Now, Section 13, if you look at Section 13 only provide Foreign Exchange Management Act that in case there is any default, any contravention of the rules and regulation, then in that case, the penalty which can be imposed is 300% of the amount involved. And in case where the amount is not verifiable, then 5 lakh rupees or whatever. But Section 13 has also been amended. Section 13.1A says that if a person is found to have acquired any foreign exchange, foreign security, or immovable property situated outside India of an aggregate value exceeding the threshold prescribed by the provision of subsection 1 of Section 37A, which is 1 crore, he shall be liable to a penalty up to 3 times or sum involved of such contravention and confiscation of the value equivalent situated in India. So primarily what it means is that ED has the power. So you have to read both in conjunction. Section 37 says upon receipt of any information or otherwise, and Section 31 and Section 13.1A says that if it is exceeding threshold, then the penalty up to 3 times the amount involved can be, or the confiscation of the value involved situated in India can be done. So which basically means, so let's say if a person has a Swiss bank account and that information has been shared by the Swiss government, and the value in the Swiss bank account is, let's say, 10 crore rupees. And the Swiss government has shared that information to the Indian government, and no action has been taken by the person resident in India under the disclosure scheme which was launched by Government of India prior to 2013. Then in that case, what will happen is that his Indian bank accounts can be, it is possible for the ED to attach his Indian bank accounts up to a value of 10 crores. So this is one of the scariest things which is happening. In fact, there was a matter again of an NRI where, you know, he was for that particular year, he was a person resident in India at that time, and he was providing some consultancy services to a Dubai-based company. And for the ease of remittance, he opened a foreign currency account in Dubai, and the entire amount was received there. The amount in question was around 2.5 crore. The enforcement director attached his and his wife's accounts were attached to that particular value. And later on, you know, of course, we find an appeal and all that stuff, and it was kind of withdrawn. But yeah, I mean, if there is any default and ED is investigating the matter, we should take it seriously, because ED has the power to attach the Indian bank account. 1B says, if the adjudicating authority in a proceeding under subsection A deems fit, he may, after reason recording the reasons in writing, recommend for the initiation of prosecution. And if the director of enforcement is satisfied, he may, after recording the reason in writing, may direct prosecution by filing a criminal complaint against the guilty person by an officer not below of the rank of assistant director. If the person is found to have acquired any foreign exchange, foreign security, or real property situated outside India of the aggregate value exceeding the threshold prescribed under provision subsection 1 of Section 37A, he shall be, in addition to the penalty imposed in section, punishable with the imprisonment term, which may extend to 5 years and fine. No court shall take cognizance of the offence under Section 1C of Section 13, except as on complaint in writing by the officer not below the rank of assistant director, referred to Section 1B. So you can see that, you know, a Foreign Exchange Management Act, which was a kind of civil offence, has been made a criminal offence. First, the value, the equivalent value can be confiscated in India. Second, criminal complaint has been filed, can be filed by the ED officer against that person. He can also impose a penalty and can also be imposed a prosecution, which or imprisonment, which could be up to a period of 5 years, and no court shall take a cognizance of that matter if the complaint has been filed. So the point is that a civil offense has been made a criminal offense very conveniently, and unfettered powers has been given to the enforcement directorate as of now. So what are the points that are investigated by the enforcement directorate? If you look at that, then it's like it's long overdue of import and export transactions, reasons for not receiving or making payment. And keep in mind, everything is linked either to this or situation similar to this. Long overdue of import export transactions, reasons for not receiving or making payments, over and under invoicing of goods and services, multiple invoicing of goods and services, falsely described goods and services, transactions to non-banking channels or other transactions, multiple accounts, overseas trust, undisclosed income, holding foreign exchange, foreign security or immovable property outside India. If you look at power of ED, I mean, this is something which is theoretical, I will say, because practically this is never followed. But if you look at Regulation 5 of Foreign Exchange Management Compounding Proceeding Rule, provides power to the Enforcement Directorate to combine contravention of the Foreign Exchange Management Act, 5 lakh or below Deputy Director, 5 to 10 lakh Additional Director, 5 10 to 50 lakh Special Director, 50 lakh to 1 crore Special Director with Deputy Legal Advisor, 1 crore or more Director of Enforcement with Special Director. But that is only with regard to Section 3A of the Foreign Exchange Management Act. That means this is only for the hawala transactions. Now, if there is any, if the ED pass any order and we are not kind of satisfied, I'll show you the process in the subsequent slide as to how the ED investigation is done. But if we are not satisfied, then an application can be filed to the Special Director appeal, which basically says that to be that any person who can be appointed as Special Director appeal, unless he is a member of Indian Legal Services and has held a post in the grade one of that services, has been a member of Indian Revenue Services, and has held a post equivalent to Joint Secretary to the Government of India. The appellate tribunal, constituted under Section 1, Section 12 of the Smugglers and Foreign Exchange Manipulator Forfeiture of Property Act, shall on and for the commencement of part of Chapter 6 and Chapter 16 of the Finance Act 2017, be the appellate tribunal for the purpose of this act, and the said appellate tribunal shall exercise jurisdiction, power and authority conferred by it under this act. So basically, the appellate tribunal for the Smugglers and Foreign Exchange Manipulators has been given the power for the Foreign Exchange Management Act also, with effect from Finance Act of 2017. Now, if you look at the ED investigation procedure, ED issues a memorandum to appear and produce document. Usually, if in case of a company, it is issued to the MD of the company or whosoever is the person concerned. Now, there are two, three things which you need to keep in mind when an ED investigation happens. So people get kind of, immediately worried the moment ED investigation summons are received. But what I suggested that you should keep your mind open and kind of look at what document are being asked for. I mean, if the documents that are being asked for related to your trade or whatever, there's not much to worry about. But if it is related to, let's say a transaction which is not in accordance with the banking channels, then you need to kind of look at it very carefully, because then the enforcement directorate can also give it a color of a prevention of money laundering act, which is a serious thing. So, but in case, let's say a documentation which has been asked by the enforcement directorate is let's say related to documents which are like 10 years back or 5 years back or 6 years back, and if additional time is required, you should file a letter to the enforcement directorate saying that since the data requested is for more than 10 years or whatever time, we need an additional time. And usually, depending upon how the officer is burdened up with the cases, anything between 2 to 8 weeks is permitted. On the given day, once you have submitted, so there are two options. One, the information can be submitted in advance, or it can be carried with you on the date given for the personal appearance. on the given date, either MD or any authorized representative of the company can appear before the authority for the investigation. Investigation usually begins with the basic questions of the transaction, and in case ED feels that you know any additional documentation is required, they will request for additional documentation or will record a statement. But usually what happens is first the information is asked, a very basic information is taken from the person who is appearing on behalf of the company. I mean, if the notice has been issued to MD, then usually they will want an MD to be there because it's also a matter of you know, power, you know, which they need to exercise. And it's best, I mean, until unless the managing director is not available or kind of, you know, if there's any other issue, then it's a different case. But if the notice has been given to MD, I mean, MD should appear before the enforcement directorate. So usually, you know, they take the document, kind of look at it, get it verified by the banks, and then record the statement. There is also a possibility right on day one, he may record the statement. When he record the statement and copy of the statement at that time is not given. So whatever, if you want to write it by pen, he will allow you to write it by pen. Otherwise, he will not give a copy of the statement. In the event ED is satisfied at the investigation stage that no offense is committed by the company, case is closed at the investigation stage itself. Otherwise, complaint is filed by the investigation officer to the regional director along with computation of the contravention committed. So what will happen is, let's say if the the Kochi branch or whatever, in the Kochi office of or the Kerala sub branch of the regional office is kind of, you know, doing the investigation, then they will file a complaint with the regional officer, with the regional director, Chennai. And then from Chennai, Ashoka's notice will be issued on the basis of complaint that has been filed. And at this stage, all documents that are shared by Enforcement Directorate on the basis of which complaint has been filed will be given to you along with the copy of the statement as well. Additional time, if required, can be sought. Otherwise, reply to the show cause notice needs to be filed within a period of 30 days from the date of receipt of notice. Matters can be represented through advocate, chartered accountant on the date of personal hearing. Usually, two hearings are given. You know, as far as regional director is concerned, regional director pass appropriate order and impose penalty. If penalty is agreeable, it can be paid. Otherwise, appeal can be filed before special director appeal within 45 days from the date of order. I have shown you who can be appointed as a special director appeal. So don't do not have much, you know, as a professional, do not have you know, kind of you know, much faith on him saying that he is going to completely remove the penalty until unless it's a completely arbitrary penalty that has been, you know, imposed. Is not going to really change any numbers, because if you look at who can be appointed, it is primarily a government officer, either a member of the Indian Legal Services or a member of Indian Revenue Services. So do you really think a person of an Indian Revenue Services who has been appointed as a special director appeal is going to change any value or any amount or any, you know, penalty that has been imposed by enforcement directors? Very difficult. So they generally do not change. So in case penalty is not agreeable, then a special director appeal, you know, appeal can be filed before the special director appeal. Again, the matter can be represented through an advocate or a CA on the date of personal hearing. There will be 2 to 3 hearings that are there. Special director appeal can either drop the case or reduce the penalty or reinstate the order of the regional director. Usually it says reinstatement of the order of the regional director. If the amount is agreeable, that can be paid or appeal can be made before the appellate tribunal for foreign exchange, usually within 45 days from the date of order. Matter can be represented. This is a proper court proceedings. Usually, you know, ex-judge of a high court or Supreme Court is kind of appointed as a chairman, and along with, you know, along with the members who have the same type of credentials. Matter can be represented through advocate on the date of personal hearing. Personal hearing can lead up to 6 to 8 hearings. Any further appeal from the appeal of Pranav Chanthi needs to be made to the Supreme Court of India. Earlier, it used to go to High Court, but with effect from 2017, Appellate Tribunal for Foreign Exchange has been made, and High Court is not involved now. The direct appeal goes to the Supreme Court. So this is broadly the process. But during the investigation procedure, what you need to do is that, I think I have do's and don'ts. Yeah, also please keep in mind that every adjudication authority and the FEMA has the same power of civil court. All proceedings before it are deemed to be judicial proceeding within the meaning of section 193 and 228 of the Indian Penal Code. Deemed to be a civil court for the purpose of section 345 and 346 of the Code of Civil Procedure. PMLA contravention is not a PMLA contravention, although there are a lot of changes that have been made by Section 37A and section and appropriate changes in Section 13, 1A, 2A, and all that stuff has been done. But still, FEMA is not prevention of money laundering. So per se, it's not a criminal offense. It still remains a civil offense. It's not a criminal offense that you should keep in mind. And accordingly, you should not worry beyond a point till the time you have the documents with you. If you can explain your situation, if you have taken appropriate actions, then there is no challenge. So if that's why I suggest my clients that if there are any outstanding import and export which are pending for a period more than 2 years, you should take it very seriously, and you should kind of take all steps with the RBI to either take an extension or to pay those off. Before you know, really get into a problem of ED investigation and all that stuff, it's better to settle it off than to do anything. Now, what is also happening now is that the income tax department, when it raids during the raid, you know, on any even the Indian trader who does not have any foreign exchange links, and if they found that they have any property outside India, or there are, you know, they have spent luxuriously during their trips outside India, or they kind of get some foreign exchange during the raid, then that matter is forwarded to the enforcement directorate. And then enforcement directorate, if they have time, I'll insist if they have time, they issue a notice and call that person. So 2020, they had a lot of time, and a lot of notices have been issued under 2020 for a general investigation, where they are just asking and probing, they are just asking question and probing. Beyond that, they're not doing much. I cannot say, but I have heard instances where some demands have also been made by ED, although I cannot say it officially. But yeah, I mean, there are a lot of investigation that have been started in the 2020 by, I mean, not by, not specifically by one office. I mean, across offices across India, a lot of investigations are being done. But to kind of stay away from the problem of enforcement directorate, we should kind of look at the transaction that has been done. Our EPDMS and IPDMS, we should review it very regularly and see that that we are not defaulting from the export and import of goods and services regulation. However, still, in case if the ED notice is issued, there are do's and don'ts, and you should very clearly adhere to it. Do's are that please provide specific information requested for. If ABC has been asked, give ABC. Do not give XYZ, because that can lead to further questions. So if he is asking for ABC, ABC is available, you will just give ABC, you will not give XYZ. Do not conceal or overstate statement. Accordingly, don'ts come is, do not conceal or overstate information. If you conceal, and because whatever information is submitted by the person who is being investigated, there are data corroborated by its bank. So once, let's say, you state, give a bank statement and conceal some facts, that bank statement will be forwarded by ED to the concerned bank, saying that you please verify, stamp it, and send it back to me. So bank will provide that information if you are concealing anything. So do not conceal or overstate anything. Please make all the statements on the basis of documents available. If the document is not available, do not make a statement. Do not make a loose comment or loose statement. Please be clear with figures. Figures has to be corroborated through your balance sheet, through your appropriate documentation that you have. No things or no maybe on figures. If you need time, please state categorically. Don't get intimidated by the environment. There, it is a civil procedure. He is doing an investigation. He cannot arrest you there and then, although he has the powers, but he has to obtain prior approvals. He cannot arrest you on the day of investigation. He has to obtain various approvals. He has to also issue a show cause. He can only investigate, file a complaint with the regional office. After the regional director, will also issue a show cause. So it's not an end of it. I mean, if the matter is getting investigated, it will get investigated properly. During investigation, be crisp, clear, confident about the statement. If any irrelevant questions are asked, you can ask the investigation officer as to why this is important. Why it is important to the matter, because you know, in the past I have seen that there are a lot of personal information that have been asked on, and that is precisely the reason why they do not allow advocates or CAs during the investigation time, because they used to ask a lot of irrelevant questions from the person whom they are investigating. How many children you have, when you were married, how many bank accounts. I mean, if the matter is related to a company, then all the questions should be asked with regard to company, not the personal questions. And a lawyer or a CA, you know, who was sitting there at that time used to, you know, kind of say that said this, I mean, used to kind of object and say that, you know, why this is important. And that's why all over India, they have taken a stand that, you know, we will not allow any lawyer or chartered accountant to interact with the investigation officer during the investigation when it is continuing. So once a notice is issued, he will not allow anybody else except the person in whose name notice has been issued, or in case he has given a power of attorney to somebody else, let's say he's not available and he has given a power of attorney, or he's authorized somebody else in the company to kind of go and give that statement to that person. Read statement before signing. If you're signing a statement, read statement before signing. If there are any changes, and there are changes because these are, you know, kind of prepared in not that great English, there could be changes in the figures. So don't think that whatever you are saying that has been typed properly. Just review everything. If any correction is required, find out that correction, get it corrected, and then only sign it. Before that, do not ask your client to, you know, sign any of the statements. And sign only those documents which has relevance to the matter, and don't sign any documentary evidence which has not been provided by you. For example, if the ED officer has obtained that piece of evidence from a banker, it is a responsibility of the banker to authenticate it. I am not going to sign it because I have not provided and I have no clue what that document is. So these are primarily do's and don'ts, and that's what I have for the present presentation. I think it covers as to what is happening right now as far as the Foreign Exchange Management Act sphere is concerned. If you have any queries, do let me know. I'd be happy to answer.
Sir, one doubt, this IE code you are referring, is it required for CA firms if we bill someone from outside India?
So generally professional, they do not touch.
It's not mandatory. Except remittance from abroad.
Yeah. No issues.
Okay. Sir, you said about write off of 5%. Is it total turnover or the 5%
during the previous, during the previous year? So if I show during you that, write off whatever you have exported during the previous 1 year, calendar year, that is something which can be done.
Okay.
Sir, set up is also not allowed, I think, as you specifically mentioned. Set up between export and import.
Yeah,
because it's not allowed.
Or with the services, it's not allowed.
With the permission of the RBI, you can do it, right?
Correct. Right.
So in case of export proceedings, if it's not remitted within 6 months, what will happen, sir?
So you know,
6 or 9 months, whatever. Now it is 15 months.
Yeah, 9 months. So let's take a 9 months as a benchmark. So if you know, in case they are not, I mean, ideally an application should be filed with the AD bank, stating that, you know, this 9 months time period, we are not able to comply due to whatever reasons that are there, and seek an extension of it. AD bank has the power to extend that up to a period of 18 months. So they do not, I mean, legally they can extend it for a period of 3 years, but usually they don't. What they do is they only extend it for a period of maximum period of 18 months. And after 18 months, they forward the application to RBI, and then RBI needs to grant the specific approval. But yeah, I mean, if it is beyond 9 months, then a specific approval should be filed.
Okay. So otherwise there should be a write-off.
Yeah.
If it is not coming, the payment. And this ESOP to foreign subsidiaries, how that will be shown? Is it automated route or you have to get a separate certificate for that?
It's up to the employer. The foreign subsidiary is under the automatic route. However, you know, under the ODI guidelines, if you look at you know, the foreign exchange management export, foreign exchange management investment in a wholly owned subsidiary and a joint venture outside India, as per those regulations, there is a form, ESOP 1 or ESOP 2 form, that needs to be filed every year by the Indian company who has given that benefit to the employer, foreign company.
It is seen that in many of the some export cases and some trade institution, they are not even bringing the money back. Now for long years it is being kept there, and I think it can attract ED attention. Now if it is
absolutely, sir, absolutely. That is what is happening. So you know, ED officer goes to the regional office of RBI, pick up all cases. I mean, they do not touch generally a low value transactions, but pick up all matters which are more than 20 crores and which has not been settled for a long period of time. And notices are issued and proceedings are initiated. So if there is anything which is beyond 20 crores and that has been pending for a long period of time, immediately action should be taken against it. See, another problem, sir, is even if ED matter is not kind of initiated and that person is kept as a in a caution listing, the company is under cautious listing, then what will happen is that his all banking rights will basically fall. I mean, nobody will give him, no bank will give him a kind of line of credit without obtaining an approval. He cannot, you know, once he's cautious listed, he can issue invoices only on receipt of advance payment. He cannot do his normal business transactions. So that will impact his doing business overall. So it should be, you know, kind of looked at very carefully.
Sir, the setting off, is it possible between the services? If he exports service and imports some service from the same party, then we set off the...
Correct. That is possible. See, the questions which are raised by AD Bank is that earlier, and that's why this December 4, 2020 notification which has come is important, because earlier it was very clearly written that, appropriate documentation with regard to bill of entry, you know, bill of lading, all that stuff should be available. And then AD Bank used to take a position that for considering for the services, all this is not applicable, so I will not permit it. I will not permit for the service, I will permit it only for the goods. But now, with this amendment, RBI has very clearly said that inter se is not possible. Goods cannot be set off against services, but goods can be set off against goods, services can be set off against services.
Okay, okay. So in that case, when the exporter files soft tests, so they can show, because it should be received within 9 months.
Correct.
So how it can be disclosed, like because money is not coming, so in the soft tax, whether they can show it is adjusted against the import service.
See, for service, for soft tax, it will become a challenge, because what happens is then you need to amend the soft tax and file a revised soft tax with the DGFT. But if it is only a service, pure service, not no software involved, then that is not reported anywhere, and it is basically a matter of, you know, kind of reconciling it in your statement and showing the invoices and doing all that stuff. Yeah, if it is related to soft tax, then soft tax needs to be amended. Revised soft tax needs to be filed for that particular period. And also you need to surrender the export benefits if any has been obtained on that
period. Okay.
I don't think there is any doubts or anything, but I think these are the things I think which we should, so auditors should know or to take care of, I think, while undertaking the audits and even going through the accounts itself. But the present and the turnout, I mean, the what is happening in our surroundings is making us feel more responsible to advise our clients.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely.
Yes.
Submits are given, sir. I will share this presentation. If anybody has any question, feel free to contact me. No issues on that.
I think it's better if you share it. I think we will post it in the website itself, sir. Those who want, you can go through it, and they can even come to you for any doubts or clarifications.
No, sir. I'll just email it right away.
Yes. Sir, it was for a 5 minutes, and it was an excellent presentation. I thought giving more lights into the FEMA provisions and also as far as our transactions as concerned. I think we need more such sessions. This time, I think what happened is that because of these deadlines, people were a little bit on a free mood or taking a leisure time. So we didn't have that much of expected turnout here. Even if it is a working day, normally I think we would have been more than 150 plus participants there would have been. Being on a Sunday and Saturday, we usually don't take any sessions. Usually we don't fix because since the cutoff date was came, the cutoff date came, we were forced to do it on 16th and 17th. That is the reason. Anyway, definitely we will have more sessions in the next year on FEMA, as well as even all those digital technologies, everything. It's a need of the hour is that. I don't know how to thank you with that short notice you came to help us. It was a big help, and we won't forget that. My personal behalf, I am thanking you, sir, for your wonderful guest here. I request Jos for the official vote of thanks, please.
Thank you so much, Mr. Varghese. No problem at all.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman C.R. Roy Varghese. Thank you, Advocate Manish, sir, for that wonderful session on FEMA and recent developments. We know it's not enough. 1.5 hours is not enough to cover all these FEMA and the recent developments itself. It is a big subject. You know, we have to spend a lot of time on this. But in a very capsule, you have elaborated on what are the recent and very important provisions in FEMA and recent developments. On behalf of Ernakulam branch and all the participants here, I extend a sincere gratitude to you for joining us on this sub-regional conference conducted these 2 days. So thank you very much, sir, for your gesture.
Thank you so
and
much.
I also thank all participants for joining for this sub-regional conference of SARC of ICI for these 2 days. Even it's Saturday and Sunday, as Chairman was telling, all this, it was after our deadline. Of course. So thank you very much for your gesture, and we will have more programs in future. Thank you once again. Have a pleasant evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.